The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
So on today's show, we're going to talk about Israel. Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. Please friend me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. Do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. Thank you all for doing your Christmas shopping and your Hanukkah and Kwanzaa shopping over at the David Feldman Show. All you had to do was see the Amazon banner, click on it, do all your shopping. We get a small percentage of everything you buy. It does not cost you more. Don't forget to subscribe for $5 a month. You can gain access to all our premium content. Hello, 2017. John Kerry made a big speech condemning Israel for the settlements in the West Bank. Everybody has an opinion about what's going on in Israel, but nobody knows anything. So on today's show, you're going to be informed. It's a new idea. It's something that maybe mainstream media should try. Actually, putting things into historical context and teaching you who the players are so that you can cobble together an informed opinion. My goal for 2017, deliver to you fewer opinions and more facts and more information so you can make an informed decision, because this country is just getting, just when you think it can't get any dumber, we get even dumber than I thought was even possible. So 2017, we're going to entertain and educate you. Fewer opinions, fewer arguments. I rarely have arguments on this show, but just, you don't have to have an opinion. You just need information. First up, my good friends, the Scots, join us. Scott Rogowsky and Scott Blakeman. And then Israel's number one television comedy writer, Daniel Lappin, joins us from Israel to explain what's going on. Stay with us. We have an entertainingly informative show.
He's got a great life.
I do think he's relatively happy.
Probably the happiest.
But he doesn't have you guys. Donald Trump doesn't have you two gentlemen. The Scots are here.
What is this, Glasgow? Are we in Scotland?
That is the voice of Scott Rogowsky.
Hello.
Who hasn't been here for a while. He is the host of Running Late.
Yeah.
And he has a new television show on Seriously.tv.
Which is not a TV network, but it's called Seriously.tv, and it was produced like a television show, but it'll be on an app. That's where we are.
Start Talking.
Yep, Start Talking in 2017. I don't know when it's airing. I don't know exactly where, but it won't be on TV.
Well, it will be on TV if you have a smart TV.
Maybe in Lithuania. They're trying to sell it to international markets. I don't know. Yeah, I guess it might be on those OTT boxes. I really have no idea. But Verizon owns the company that produced it, so if you have Verizon, it might be on your Verizon cable box.
In the year to come, by the way, happy 2017. In the year to come, more and more television is going to be produced for the phone.
Mm-hmm.
So
that's what these companies are banking on. But
yeah, AT&T and
I mean,
I watch TV on my phone.
Do you?
Actually, yeah, I do. Scott Rogowsky, good to see you.
Yeah, it's good to be back.
Scott Blakeman, always a pleasure.
David, Happy New Year.
Happy New Year. You know Scott from MSNBC, Laughing Liberally, and Stand Up for Peace. You'll be at Brandeis University.
Yes, with Dean Obadala. I've been doing this show for like 13 years now, and look at the progress we've made because of that show. They've never been closer. But Dean and I love doing the show. It's really a way to bring, starting a new year.
I don't think the audience knows what you're talking about.
Well, I'm a Jewish comedian.
You're Jewish?
Yeah, it's first in comedy. I don't think there are. Scott is also, but I think that's, and you are, but other than the three of us, I think that's it. And Dean is a Muslim American, a Palestinian American. And so we've been doing the show for 13 years. Basically, it sounds like in the old days, remember National Brotherhood Week? That was always, apparently they don't celebrate anymore. But, you know, we do a lot of colleges. We bring together Jewish, Arab, Muslim students of all backgrounds. And it's a comedy show, but it's a way, we always say, if we can laugh together, we can live together. And the best way to start a conversation is with laughter. And especially in these ridiculously fractious times, and I think comedy more than ever is going to be a way to try to get people to listen and send a message. So we do colleges, and it's very inspiring. We're doing Brandeis. I've been wanting to do that for a long time, and University of Pittsburgh. And we've done a lot of schools in the South where we're both exotic, you know. So looking forward to doing more of that in the new year.
What's the best way to end a conversation?
Thank you and good night.
Or do you know David Feldman?
Punch to the throat.
So I'm going to talk about the third rail of politics and comedy, and it's Israel. And this is going to be a difficult show to do because we have three Jews. Let me start off by telling you that my father said to me, never talk about being Jewish on stage. He said, don't change your name, but don't be a Jew on stage. And I'm not. I don't. I mean, it's implicit, but I really don't. It's only recently I have a couple of jokes where I say I'm Jewish. But I never really wanted to be a Jewish comic, especially because I started in San Francisco. And they have Jews there, but they you weren't going to get any laughs. And I was afraid to be a Jew. It's bad enough my name is Feldman. Why not just be a comic?
But you wrestled under the name Bruno Sammartino.
Bruno Sammartino. Oh, my God. So oh
that
my
brings it all
God.
Back.
You changed your name for your wrestling career.
Oh, my God. I haven't heard that name since I was 9 years old.
And Gorilla Monsoon was his big rival. And
Killer Kowalski.
But to this day, though, I remember being a kid watching. I believed that wrestling was real. And I thought Bruno Sammartino, he's the good guy. Gorilla Monsoon, who apparently in real life was a good guy, too. But I really thought that was one of the first disappointments in life, going, no, it's fixed. What? But it was at Madison Square Garden. They would have 20,000 people. In my 9-year-old view, it seemed like it was real. And I loved him. And Argentino Apollo, who wrestled barefoot.
Hmm. We're talking about Jews.
Yeah. Yes, they're all again all Jews.
This is my plan to derail this from the.
But
yeah,
wrestling is fixed, and a couple of our noses are too. So actually, I did not have hair plugs, no nose job.
Never. I got my nose extended because it wasn't. I went for the augmentation.
So we're at a crisis now here in America. The Jews in America are well. This
any
is,
different today than it was 20 years ago, 50 years ago?
Well, this is a very offensive thing for Jews to address because we're at a tipping point, and you know how much – hang on, let me get to the joke. Hang on. Let me have a glass of water. Hang on. Can you guys just be quiet for a second? And you know how much we hate to tip. End of joke. Now laugh.
Why spoil a good meal with a big tip? That's straight out of Alan King's Jewish joke book.
Oh, really? All right.
And he could afford to tip.
Yeah,
and
that's exactly.
I love to do is say, I can't pay you. I have the money. I just can't. I just cannot.
That's what Trump would be at a restaurant.
I know. Yeah.
Jean Jours, you go, I don't really have the money.
Yeah. Well, let me say something. Yeah. So make a note. I want to talk about that for a second. But American Jews and Israel and Zionism and stuff like that, it's very difficult to talk about. And because this is a podcast.
So we'll live forever and we'll be judged against this the rest of our lives.
Yeah.
And we'll never work any Chabad shows.
So, Scott, so if you're not Jewish, let's do this show for the non-Jews who hear about Israel, and it's very hard to understand the Middle East. It's kind of like it really is. I hate to say this. It's really like the housing crisis, the securitization of mortgages and tranches and it's you know, leave it to the Jews to invent something that
– with more layers of complexity.
Yes. So – Israel is complicated, and sometimes you just have to do a gut check and say, do I hate Jews or not? That's basically, you got a bottom line.
From there. Yeah,
get down to the bottom line. Because the issue with Israel is, do you believe the Jews should have a state? Should there be a place where Jews can get the hell out of our country and go someplace else and leave us the F alone? And if you don't believe that there should be a Jewish state, then everything is off.
Because we already have a Jewish state in New York. But aside right. from that, I know, just, and this is something that, look, I've been doing the show for 30 years. I have an interest in that, far from knowledgeable fact. There's many books I should read about it. But to me, actually, is on the one hand, by the way, this isn't just for non-Jews. I think there's an incredible lack of awareness and ignorance in the Jewish community. And there's an expression that I didn't make up, PEP, progressive except on Palestine. And I see on Facebook people who are liberal by any other standard and, you know, were livid at John Kerry's speech, which I thought was great the other day. And all – and it's a weird time because in general, you know, people forget Bill Clinton went to Gaza and was embraced by children there and Hillary Clinton hugged Arafat and she got vilified for that. But President Obama has done nothing everything he's done, I think, is pro-Israel. I mean, it's all semantics because I'm would be called a self-hating Jew. Like, well, first of all, the Netanyahu – I'm jumping right
ahead. Well, we're going to talk a lot about it, so go ahead.
I guess the main thing is to look
at – Let me ask you a couple questions.
Sure.
Let me ask you a couple questions. Let's start off slowly because I do want to talk about this. It's a big story, whether or not Americans want it to be, because we're in bed with Israel as Americans and – they're our ally in the Middle East.
But now why is that?
Okay, but let me introduce you to our audience, Scott Blakeman and Scott Rogowsky. Mm-hmm. Scott Rogowsky, were you bar mitzvahed?
I was.
And is Marty your father?
He is.
And what does...
We all know Marty.
Marty is your father. And is Marty a president
of a temple? Does that make me more Jewish, having a father named Marty?
Is he a president of a temple?
Well, he's a former president of a temple.
Yeah. What temple?
The Jewish Community Center of Harrison, New York.
And so Judaism is very important in your upbringing.
In my upbringing. I was raised in a kosher home, a conservative synagogue. Yeah, I attended temple a lot, been to Israel twice. And yes, I mean, I would say there is a Zionist bent to our family and our family's history in terms of, you know, my grandparents just giving money and Hadassah and all these organizations, the Jewish Appeal and all the UJA and all these things. There's a deep vein in our family.
Scott Blakeman. Bar mitzvahed?
Bar mitzvahed, yes.
Where'd you go to Hebrew school?
I went to Temple Beth El, Manhattan Beach, and I went to Hebrew school and I...
Orthodox, conservative?
Conservative. And I went to Camp Ramah in the Berkshires for 3 years, a Jewish camp. And always from the moment... I did comedy against, you talk about San Francisco, I'm Jewish, and commercial auditions, the last thing they want to hear. So I've always been, you know,
you always opened with I'm Jewish.
Well, not literally, but I felt that was what I wanted to talk about. And to me still, it's like, oh, you know, any Jews out there, it's not that, you know, that's, I can do a whole act of that or not, but I've always felt very Jewish. And it's a complicated thing because one thing I want to stress is that anyone, we're all pro-Israel, you know, and it's just like in America, we love America, but we might disagree with Trump or Bush or someone might disagree with Obama. I'm not anti-American, but yet there's this thing that if you say, gee, it might be better for Israel if they had this policy. Oh, you're a self-hating Jew. Oh, you're anti-Israel. You're anti-Semitic. This is the kind of rhetoric that makes the conversation toxic.
Well, it's the exact same, and you said it perfectly because it mirrors the far right in America who you criticize, you know, your country's policies, and you're anti-American, and then the
but
real
that's
Americans
only here
are
in
all
America.
That.
In Israel, you can criticize Israel.
There's a lot of dissension.
Yeah. But here, it's the far right here, on the Jewish side, the people who are happy that David Friedman was appointed to the ambassadorship, and all those people, those are the people who are so vehemently criticizing the other Jews who try to speak up and maybe want to...
Beyond criticizing, right. They call us capos or cap, whatever the word is, people who collaborated with the Nazis.
Right.
So it's
insane.
But let me get my arms around this because a lot of my listeners are not Jewish, and a lot
so
of them,
sorry.
Yeah, and a lot of them are Jewish. And as you said earlier, a lot of Jews really don't follow this that closely, what's going on in Israel. So let me ask you a couple of questions and stay on point, if you don't mind.
Okay?
Because I want to explain to people who are listening what is going on in Israel objectively. I want to give information. I don't want to have so much opinion as facts here, because Scott Blakeman, you work with Dean very closely. Mm-hmm. You go to colleges trying to – Dean is a Palestinian. Mm-hmm. What's the matter?
No, nothing. It was good. It's a good conversation.
Oh, okay. You were moaning.
Yeah, I moan when I'm stimulated.
Oh.
Yeah.
What I want out of this show is people to understand what's going on in Israel, because most people don't understand it. They don't know what's going on because it's complicated. So I just and you've worked for the past 13 years?
Yeah.
Have you had a bar mitzvah for the show yet?
That'd be a good selling point for the coming year. Yeah, the bar mitzvah.
You work with Dean, who is a Palestinian.
Palestinian-American Muslim, yes.
Yes. And you try to explain what's going on. So let's start where you're coming from. So, Scott, conservative temple?
Yes, and I've seen Fiddler on the Roof 3 times in the past 6 months.
Okay. Have you really?
Yeah.
Different cast?
No, same. Okay. There's a stand-in one.
Could I top you on that very quickly?
Yeah.
I dated Sheldon Harnick's stepdaughter.
Wow.
Sheldon Harnick wrote Fiddler on the
Roof,
the book?
Yes, and so, okay. Anyway. Not to be competitive, but I just
want to get answer the, both of you, just give me a number. How many years of Hebrew school did you have?
Oh, boy. I went until I was 16, and I started when I was probably nursery school, so 12, 13 years.
Did you like it?
I liked it because I was the class clown in Hebrew school, and I spent more time in the principal's office than I did in the classroom.
And did they get mad at you when you were in the principal's office, or did they kind of just shrug it off?
No, I mean, I got disciplined, you know, but it's Hebrew school. It's not real school, so what are they going to do? It's not going to end up in my permanent record.
Right. Yeah.
That's why I used that. It was my outlet. In school, I was a very good student. In Hebrew school, I put diapers on my head and ran around the classroom. Literally. That's the kind of thing I would do.
And that's how the Lubavitchers were invented. Yeah. So, can you read Hebrew?
Yeah.
Can you?
With vowels.
Yeah, that's tough without it.
Without the vowels, I could take a guess.
Yeah. And can you speak it?
Not really, no.
Can you understand it?
Not really, no.
Did your parents speak Yiddish when you were growing up?
No. Except for the few mishuganas and mishpachas.
Did they want you to use Yiddish expressions when you were growing up?
Did they want me to? No, we never had a mandate to use nachas more often.
Did they want you to assimilate and not use Yiddish?
Yiddish was never a part of my family tradition. I don't think even my grandparents spoke it. They're from Poland. My great grandfather's from Poland. My father's side and my mother's side, they're from Hungary, Austria-Hungary.
Mm-hmm. Scott Blakeman, how many years did you?
Very similar to Scott. I mean, it's probably the same amount of years in Hebrew school. I even went to Hebrew high school. Yeah. It was one. It was still part of the Hebrew school, and that was my class clown training too. I mean, again in. You know, secular school, it was different. You know, it was a little funny, but
right.
But no, I remember there was a turning point how I decided to become a comedian without realizing it early on. And we had Gveret Goodman, Mrs. Goodman, and Mr. Ostrow. But there was, going way back, there was Philo Kvetch was a character from either Soupy Sales or some local New York, it may have been Soupy Sales. And there was a figure in Jewish history, Philo. So the teacher said, and Philo. And I knew in the split second, if I said Philo, when my high-pitched voice, Philo Kvetch, the whole room would crack up and they'd throw me out. And so I had that moment, and I said, I'm going for the laugh. And I said, Philo Kvetch, huge laugh, leave the room. So that was sort of a turning point. But, yeah, it was definitely a training.
And when you left the room, were you happy?
I think I was. I think because I knew that was going to happen.
Yeah.
And I got the laugh. So I didn't become a comedian the next day, but I think that, you know.
And you left the room, you stood out in the hall.
Yeah, probably for a second. I don't know if the parents would complain. He's alone in the hall. But, uh-huh.
Can you read Hebrew?
I can read Hebrew, but I really don't understand it. And
how many trips to Israel?
well, this is a sticking point. None, and I've been booed and hissed for this at Jewish singles events, which I performed at many, not by my choice. I mean, I'd love to go tomorrow. I mean, it's just, I didn't do Birthright. Maybe they didn't have Birthright.
What does Birthright mean? Very quickly.
Well, I think, I think up to a certain age, you're able to get a free trip. It's one of the only good things Sheldon Adelson does. He funds.
Who is Sheldon Adelson?
He's a rich
Jew.
Far right Jewish Republican who funds bad candidates,
Birthright is the right of every Jewish American to get drunk and hook up with other Jewish Americans in Israel.
And I so wanted to do that, but they didn't have it then. So I haven't been there. I want to go there.
Okay. I have a line of questioning here so my listeners can understand this. So you brought up Sheldon Adelson. He is a ultra-right-wing Jew who owns the Venetian in Las Vegas.
And also one of the newspapers, unfortunately.
He just bought the newspaper in Las Vegas, and he's also created a right-wing rag in Israel that people are reading. Mm. I want to talk about the right-wing strain of American Judaism, and then we'll get to Israel. 20% of American Jews are Republicans, tend to vote Republicans. Growing up, what were you instilled when it came to politics, Scott?
Democrat all the way. Vote row A. Yeah, it was just Democrats. I mean, my father's a Democratic politician. Yeah, so there's nothing but in my family.
Right.
My uncle, my mom's brother, leans a little. He's definitely one of those anti-Hillary, anti-Obama Jewish because of the Israel element. Right. I mean, the Israel element dominates.
Go ahead.
So he runs on that in that race a little bit, and I have a crazy cousin Jerry who's also totally no Obama, anti-Hillary, and I think the Israel part plays a big role in that.
Scott,
again, I feel like we share the same lives. 100% Democratic, and I don't think we knew Republicans. And my late Uncle Mel on my. who married my late Aunt Mitzi was in that in his day it was like, oh, Mel is conservative, and you know, he passed away about a year and a half ago. Talking to him in his later years, like, he thought Fox News and all that was crazy. So in my day it was like conservative because he was probably more like a moderate Republican, but no, definitely Democratic. And I think the Israel issue, it was different then too. And and I remember I'm not going to hide my age here because 1967, I was alive.
We'll get to that.
Okay, sure.
Okay. So you were raised liberally and most.
Although I was a conservative growing up. I mean, when I was 13, I was for Barry Goldwater. I mean, really? That was I never did drugs, so that was my rebellion. And, it was a momentary thing, so my parents are horrified by that. But,
You were raised in a conservative temple.
Well, it's more conservative reform. Yeah, that's one of the confusing things about Judaism. It's not really conservative, but
it's
they call
political
it that.
Affiliation.
Yeah, we had an organ and a choir. That's reform. When I went to Camp Ramah, they go, that's not conservative. But
right. So if you're not Jewish, there are essentially three strains of Judaism: Reformed, which is they do the service in Latin, and there's Reformed.
What's Woody Allen's joke? My rabbi was reformed, very reformed. He was a Nazi.
Right. right. Conservative.
Actually Orthodox. Reconstructionist, which is an interesting thing, but it's probably for another show. But it's not as form as reform, but also very – like I went to a Reconstructionist high holiday service, and you have storytelling. More, it's a bringer show too, but that's something else. But I was married by a female rabbi, not two, but well, that would have been okay too. But
did you guys sing the Hatikva in Hebrew school?
And I still love that song. I get choked up.
Yeah, the national anthem.
It's the Israeli national anthem.
Much better than ours. I mean,
was there an Israeli flag?
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah. Sure. Yeah, I'm sure there was.
It's just the Star of David, or it's the blue and white, and
Israeli Day parades. We participate in all that stuff. Yeah,
but again, it was issues were different.
Grew up singing the Israeli national anthem.
Not all day, but on occasion. Yeah.
And did you swear an oath to the nation of Israel?
No.
I don't think so. They didn't train us in arms. And
can the Democratic Party...
I love Feldman's line of questioning.
Is the Democratic Party going to survive without Jews? If the Republicans can start siphoning off the Jews from the Democratic Party, does that bode well for the Democratic Party?
Well, I don't think they are. I mean, I think that, first of all, you know, the one issue will – and first of all, it's a bogus issue that it's an issue, because Democrats – in fact, President Obama got a lot of opposition just now from a lot of Democrats. So the Democratic position toward Israel – is I think they're trying to, certainly, and I think more Jews gravitated Republican lately than ever, maybe, and some Jews are just getting naturally more conservative for other reasons, but I don't think that's going to be the death knell for the Democratic Party, because Jews essentially still we were in the forefront of the civil rights movement. I still think that Jews are more progressive on most issues, and that Israel is this anomaly, which I don't think should be. So I don't think that would be enough to...
But if the Jews start going to the Republicans, Scott Rogowsky,
yeah,
what do you think happens to the Democratic Party?
I think it'll be in the same tattered state it's in right now. It's, I mean, both parties, you know, there needs to be a shakeup in the party system, but... I think it comes down to age. I think the older you get,
no. Answer my question. What happens to the Democratic Party?
I can't tell you, Dave. I don't know.
Well, what do you notice about Democrats who are not Jewish and young Democrats?
Young Democrats. There are a lot of these free Palestine in like the college campuses now. College campuses are becoming decidedly pro-Palestine. Mm-hmm. I think, and a lot of those people are Democrat.
But Republicans are much worse, so they're not going to leave. They may not be as involved.
Right, but they're taking – right. So I don't think they're pro-Palestine and also, you know, pro-life in terms of, you know, abortions here, which is kind of
– Would you say that there's a strain of anti-Semitism in the Democratic Party?
Oh, I don't think there is in the Democratic
Party. I think in the far left there might be.
Yeah, I mean, that's, again, gets into that issue
because
earlier.
Of the Palestine issue.
Yeah, like, is it anti-Semitic to say that I disagree with the Israeli government at the time? You know, so that's the question that is used a lot. And that
is it anti-Semitic to call Israel an apartheid state?
It's not anti-Semitic. It's not accurate at the moment. It's accurate. It can it will be if it goes this way.
That's the question. How do you separate Israel from Jews? And being anti-Israel versus being anti-Semitic, I mean, what is anti-Semitism? I mean, that gets, you know, that's become a larger and larger umbrella, I think, over the years.
Yeah. All right, I'm going to ask you a really difficult question.
Okay.
This is going to be...
We got a lifeline.
If the Republican Party is the party of racism, would Jews find... comfortable place in the Republican Party among racists?
No, and I don't.
Is there a danger? Is there a strain of racism in Judaism?
I mean, I think they're racist in every. You can't make that. You can't paint that brush. There's, you know, yes, they're going to be racist Jews. They're racist Lutherans. They're racist Muslims. They're racist everybody. Everyone's got a racist element to their people. I mean, everyone's on the spectrum. So, you know, I mean, that's a silly statement.
Yeah, I would say, though, again, I hate to malign any group and any broad brushing, which I don't mean to. I think even before this latest Orthodox Jewish communities tended to vote pretty Republican and, for various reasons, be more conservative in a lot of ways. So they are the ones, I think, that are peeling off into the Republican Party even now. And look, yes, I think maybe if there are any Jews that might tend, you know, I always feel that the most religious of anyone should be the most peace loving and tolerant, and it seems like it's the opposite in every religion.
Opposite.
So if there is any of that, I've encountered some racism among Orthodox Jews. I think many do hate President Obama for not any reasons that are reasonable. So, but I don't think Jews should ever find a home in the Republican Party, because they don't like Jews.
Right.
If they say they like Israel. The real reason, I mean, the fundamentalist Christians want Israel to be in charge so they can come in, you know, the whole rapture thing, so they could take over. So it's a Republicans don't like Jews, right, even if they say that they like Israel.
All right, so let's go to Israel now. So we have American Jews who don't know if Judaism is a religion or a race of people or both. We have American Jews who don't know if Israel is synonymous with Judaism. We have Jews who are Zionists and Jews who are not Zionists. Very quickly, define Zionist.
Well, maybe Scott can do that. I mean, because again, that's a tricky thing. I guess if you believe, I mean, if you would say that you believe there should be, because yeah, it tends to be associated with more far right people. But I think in its essence, it's you support the right of Israel to exist.
Right.
You know, and but then that it's a whole area now. And
see, now in the history of Zionism, Zionism believes that
there should be a Jewish state.
A Jewish state, preferably in Israel.
In Israel, right.
But again, they considered Uganda. That was one of the where they thought.
I mean, take Wyoming.
Yeah.
It might have been a better move.
Yeah. Did Zionism exist before the Holocaust?
Yes.
Well, the whole Balfour Declaration, all that in the 20s.
Theodore Herzl. I mean, all the. Yeah.
So there was an idea of a Jewish homeland before the Holocaust.
Yeah.
They wanted to come back. And there was this plot of land.
British-controlled, right?
British-controlled that became Israel. So we're living in an era of fake news where we're told one thing and people believe another, and everybody has their own version of events.
Right. And there are 20 books to back it up now, too.
Yes. The founding myth of Israel. What year was Israel founded?
1948
is the.
Okay. Now, it was founded in 1948.
May, I believe. May.
Okay. The Palestinians have their version of events, and the Jews have their version of events. Growing up, I had the Jewish story. And Scott Blakeman, you work with Dean. You go around the country. He's Palestinian. He has his version of events. So why don't we – and why don't we have Scott Rogowsky describe what the Jews are taught, and then you'll tell – then Mr. Blakeman will tell us what the Palestinians are taught. 1948, it's 3 years after the Holocaust,
right.
6 million Jews.
Once all everything came to light, and then there was an international coalition, a moral obligation, it felt like, right, to create a safe space to prevent this from ever happening again, a place where Jews won't be decimated by the millions and have a genocide completely wipe them out again, the remaining Jews that were left. So David Ben-Gurion, a lot of these statesmen and you know, I'm not too.
That's all right. But
smart. I'm not specifics, but I guess it was the UN involved, or was the UN?
It was British controlled.
Yes, British.
And the UN and the Jews and the Arabs decided they would split. Now, this is the version of events that I was taught. That the UN, the Israelis bombed the King David Hotel, created an uprising. The British left. They said, we can't take it anymore. We're out of here. And the UN said, okay, we're going to divide Palestine into two separate countries. One side will be for the Jews, and the other side will be for the Palestinians. The Jews accepted this. This is my and the Palestinians and the Arabs said no.
So as soon as it was established, they attacked.
So five, Jordan, Egypt, Saudi Arabia, Lebanon,
Syria,
they invaded Palestine, the Jewish quarter, the Palestinians were told by the Arabs to leave until the war is over, and then you'll get the whole country. And to everybody's surprise, the Jews won the Palestinian section of the country, and they said, it's ours. We had a war. You didn't want to share this land. Now you get nothing. And the Jewish state was...
The borders were defined, yeah.
The borders were defined. Is that pretty much how we were taught?
That's how it is. So it's like, and that goes to today. It's like from the very moment of inception, we were under attack. And so now it's like, you know, 60 years later, 70 years later, it's we're still being attacked. But now because we defend ourselves, we get...
But that's what you were taught.
That's what we were taught, yes.
Okay, Scott Blakeman. You tour with Dean. Yeah. How do you pronounce his last name?
Obidallah. But he's an American, you know, Palestinian-American.
But he's a Palestinian-American.
Yes. Yeah.
So he was taught something else.
Yeah, I mean, I just want to quickly preface by saying that's not the focal point of the show, because we say whatever, we're never going to agree on what happened, but now let's be practical as comedians are. How do we live in peace? Now,
but what is his
version? I mean, I can't speak for him. And again, there's a great book by Benny, which I haven't read, which I want to read, 1948, by Benny Morris, who's an Israeli historian. And there's a lot of facts I don't know. I think the biggest sticking point from what I know is that when you said the Arabs told the Palestinians to leave and they come back, I think that there's documentation that it was, and again, this is, I need to read more, that there was some ethnic cleansing that Israelis did. It wasn't strictly the Palestinians wanted to leave. They were driven out by Israelis. So, you know, again,
When you say ethnic cleansing, were they?
Well, I mean, this is what some people refer. This is what some people say. Okay. I mean, it's called the Nakba. The catastrophe. I think that 1948 is a good book to read. I mean, I think it's weird how there could be gray area because it's just facts, but. Yeah, but I think it would be fair to say that, yes, the Arab countries did attack. But the fact that the big point of contention is that the Arabs told Palestinians to leave, I think they would say, no, the Israelis, you know, forced them out and to this day took away homes. This is sort of the backdrop. But a lot has happened since 1948.
Is it true that – well, you're not Palestinian.
Yeah.
So let's go through the history here.
And that's booking here. You kind of put the Palestinian to have this conversation.
Yeah. Well, I like to talk about women's issues with that women present. Yeah.
Why don't we get Dean in here?
Yeah. So the Israeli state was founded in 1948, and now you had these, for lack of a better word, indigenous people, the Palestinians, Arabs, non-Jews – living in Israel. Was there ever a country called Palestine?
Well, it used to be called Palestine, but there are people on the right and Jewish community who say there's no such thing as a Palestinian. It's invented people. Newt Gingrich said that. But they were living there with the Jews for decades thousands of years. I mean, that's the thing. Some people say, no, that's why I think it's pointless to go, well, we – because you're never going to find the facts. Like Jews will say, well, the 1200, we go back to that. And then they could say, no. So we're never going to resolve that. So I guess it comes back to it doesn't really matter. What matters is 2017 and that there have been so many
But, I mean, the version of events that I have is that Yasser Arafat, who was the leader of the Palestinian Liberation Organization, was born in Egypt. In fact, either he or his brother ran the Egyptian automobile club.
Oh.
Did you know that?
Did they get the discount on those days?
AAA for Egypt?
Yeah, the Car Bomb Association of the Arab. But there were really not that many people living in Palestine.
Well, Jordan, again, this is something I should know more about. Jordan had jurisdiction over Palestinians for some time, and there were some people saying that should be a Palestinian state.
Well, Jordan, so as I understand it, Jordan had the largest population and still does have the largest population of Palestinians. Something like 2 million Palestinians live in Jordan right now. Okay, so 1967, Six-Day War?
Mm-hmm.
What was the Six-Day War? Because this is crucial to understanding the demographic and geographic problem that confronts Israel. And
well, that's the key there. And again, I remember, and now I could quickly just say, to give a little background, that I remember being 13 in school and listening to the radio, and that, oh, the Israelis are beating the Arabs, and we were cheering. And I did this, I remember, so just to show you the context and everything. But there's some dispute. There's a book by, I think, Regev, and about what started the Six War.
Was it a preemptive war or
well,
a preventative
yeah,
war?
But, yeah. So no, I don't really know. I mean, was it just Egypt attacking, or did Israel sort of bring it on? So again, but the big thing that came out of it was the West Bank and, you know, Gaza taking this extra territory. And that's really brings us up to date with the big crux of the problem is.
Well,
that,
let's, but yeah. People need to understand this, because yeah. This is where it gets really, people don't know this.
Yeah.
Okay. So what you had in 1967 was an area called the West Bank and East Jerusalem, which was controlled by Jordan. And you had a couple of million, quote-unquote, Palestinians living under Jordanian rule. They were not citizens. They were just in a – they were just kind of a fish nor fowl. And Israel, I was taught, was attacked – by five Arab countries. I've since learned that it was probably a preventative war started by Israel as opposed to a preemptive war. And I think preemptive wars are illegal. Iraq was a preventive war. When we invaded Iraq, it was a preventive war, and that's against UN.
Preemptive.
Preemptive war is okay.
But preventive is
a preventive illegal. War is illegal, because a preventive war – you know, Hitler, when he went into the Sudetenland and the yeah. Rhine, that was a preventing war. I'm going in there to protect the Germans who are living there. And anyway, the story is that I think it was Golda Meir, who was the prime minister at the time in 67, saw tanks coming to the border. And they invaded. They invaded Egypt. They invaded Jordan, Lebanon, Syria. And some say that's a preemptive war. Some say it's a preventive war. And when we were kids, we thought Israel was doomed. And then suddenly we heard about these Israeli jet fighters who were incredible. And the war was over in 6 days. And the Jews were triumphant, and they took the West Bank and East Jerusalem from Jordan. Jordan, as I understand it, tried to invade Israel, and the Israelis pushed them back and took the West Bank and East Jerusalem. And the war was over. And so they got the West Bank and East Jerusalem, but with the West Bank came Palestinians. And at the time, a lot of people were worried. They said, what are we going to do with these Palestinians? Is that how you?
I think even David Ben-Gurion was one of the voices saying we should not, it's not going to be good for the future.
Who was David Ben-Gurion?
He was the first president of Israel and, you know, obviously his most prominent leader at the time. And many voices at that time said, if we get involved with this, it's not going to be good for our future. So there was some counseling not to take that land. You know, I think, and again, I should know this, but with Syria and the Golan Heights, that may have been from a later war, but that's the dispute.
And the Golan Heights were taken from Syria.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, but there were voices at the time saying this will be settlements, it's not going to be good for our future, but the overriding, and I don't think they knew what they were going to do with it initially, and maybe some were saying then what they're saying now, annexing it. So there was discussion even then what to do.
Were there Jews who were eyeing the West Bank before 1967? Biblically. Samaria, there is a belief that the West Bank...
You got Jericho there. Yeah, a lot of these biblical cities that are, you know, I guess...
Was it Judah and Samaria?
Anciently, historically considered, you know, Israel. Canaan.
So there were Jews.
I'm sure there were.
Who believed that Israel was incomplete without the West Bank.
Right.
So they didn't just take the West Bank as a buffer between Israel and Jordan. That's how it was sold to people. Well, we need this little space here. There were Jews who really wanted East Jerusalem and the West Bank.
I'm sure. And there are settlements today. I mean, there are people who have, you know, I think that's the root of it, right?
Well, we'll get to the settlements in a second. So now you have the Palestinians in the West Bank, and then they also got a piece of land from Egypt called
the Gaza Strip.
The Gaza Strip. Now, is the Gaza Strip connected to the West Bank?
No.
No, it's totally. It's,
right? So yeah. The Israelis won the battle in the Sinai Desert in 67, and they took the Sinai Desert from the Egyptians. And as part of a peace settlement, the Israelis took Gaza. And with that came the Palestinians who live in Gaza. So the Palestinians, after 67, lived in two places. The West Bank, which is to the east of Israel, and Gaza, which is to the south,
southwest,
or, you know, up against Egypt. That's where the Palestinians were living. Is that the only place the Palestinians were living? Because that's, we seem to just only hear about the Palestinians in the West Bank.
Oh, no, I mean, there are Palestinians living in Israel proper, certainly, yeah.
What percentage, it's 20% of Israel, is Arab, Palestinian? Are they allowed to vote?
They are allowed to vote. I mean, I...
they're allowed to vote? Yes. Are they allowed to hold office in the Knesset, which is the parliament for Israel? They are. Do they serve in the armed forces?
I think they are, yeah.
Yeah, they serve in the armed forces. Yeah. Are they second-class citizens?
Apparently.
Yes. Are they becoming second-class citizens? Are they becoming third-class citizens?
Yes.
Okay. There are a lot of classes in Israel, I learned. I mean, you got the Ethiopian Jews and
well, even among the Jews.
Even among the Jews there are. And the Sabra, and Russian Jews, and there's all these different... I mean,
Israel's become more conservative by a lot of...
But we'll get there. We'll get there. Okay. So the Arabs who live in Israel proper, they don't call themselves Palestinians.
No, Israelis.
Oh, they are pledging their allegiance to Israel.
Call themselves Arabs.
Arab Israelis, I guess, yeah.
Yeah, but they don't call themselves Palestinians. No. So we have this people, the Palestinian people, after 48, and then especially after 48, they were basically living in Jordan. That's where they ended up. They ended up in refugee camps in Jordan. Some of them became citizens. Most of them didn't. They ended up in refugee camps after 67 in Lebanon. They became itinerant workers hired by the Kuwaitis. They were never really accepted by the Arab nations, were they? They were never allowed just become citizens of Syria or...
I think Jordan had even some kind of a massacre at some point of Palestinians. So, yeah, I think Palestinians be the first to say that they haven't been welcomed by anybody, unfortunately. So it's not just Israel, but it's a lot of Arab nations, too.
They are in refugee camps scattered throughout the Middle East. And so... they've been reproducing in those refugee camps, and they're
boiling over with
a couple of million now living.
Gaza's cramped, this cramped little area.
Right. So then there was another war in 74.
73, I think. The Yom Kippur War?
The Yom Kippur War in 73, which Israel almost lost, but for the help of Henry Kissinger. At one point... Sadat, who was the leader of Egypt, had the Israeli army surrounded, and there was some help given by the United States, and it's kind of an embarrassing. There were cracks in Israel's defenses. After that, the Palestinians under Yasser Arafat began to get kicked out of Jordan, and they moved to Lebanon and then Tunis or Tunisia.
Well, I think Arafat was based there for a while.
Yeah. And they became a terrorist organization and began saying, we want Israel. And they started hijacking planes and blowing up things. And we are now left with the hopes of a two-state solution, where the Palestinians would have the West Bank and then an unconnected piece of land called the Gaza Strip, and they would create a nation out of that.
You have to bridge those two areas somehow.
Yeah. And America, under Bill Clinton in 2000, the Camp David Accords, we came very close to a two-state solution. But Yasser Arafat said, if I sign this deal, they'll kill me. I'll be killed by my people.
Now, why is that? Because they want everything. Because that's the thing. Both sides want everything.
Well, I think I interviewed, actually, when I did this talk show, then Clinton's press secretary in those final months, and he said, like you said, David, that they were very, very close. And even within that, there's some question whether, I guess, was it Olmert was the...
Ehud Barak, I believe.
Barak was there. There was some question that even he would have had trouble selling it back to the Israeli people. But I know that the story is that Arafat walked away. But and even if that's true, though, picking up in 2000, everyone dropped the ball at that point, including the Bush administration here. You know, just because something doesn't work out momentarily, if you really want it. So that was really the key. No one wanted to follow up. And to me, that's why it is the saddest conflict of all, because even hearing your story, which, by the way, you know more than Scott and I think put together. And
no,
and
that's not true.
But it's really a service what you're doing, because just laying it out this way. But it's sad because they
but
were
I'm leaving out the intifada in the
right. And no,
something.
Look, there was reasons to be an Israeli state, and there was reasons to fear terrorism. But at a certain point, the Palestinian people and the PLO morphed from a terrorist organization, the same way the IRA morphed into a political organization. But sadly, after the Intifada, the Israeli government was just attacking Arafat and just kind of destroying his base of power, even though he had morphed more politically. But there's the Oslo Accords. These last 16 years, it's just the way we feel with Trump. Someone wrote, it's like a car crash happening in slow motion. There's so much that we could have been doing and can still do. Look, and I know you laid out the history beautifully, but I would have to say now it doesn't matter. What matters now is how do we go forward? How can we be practical? And yes, you could be an Israeli and say, no, it's always been in our history. We want it. Okay, fine. And the reality is, if you don't have a two-state solution, you can have a one-state solution, which will be either it's not a Jewish state anymore because it's...
Explain the demographic. So here is when they call Israel an apartheid state.
Well, when I take issue with that, obviously the West
Bank...
Explain
the demographic problem that's confronting.
Well, I mean, you know, as you said, there will be a Palestinian majority, and so either Israel ceases to be democratic...
That's if you include Gaza and the West Bank.
Well, Gaza is part of Palestine. It was given up in 2005.
So I'm saying there'll be an Israeli... There'll be a Palestinian majority if you do a census that includes the West Bank and Gaza.
Yes, well, because it's under Israeli control, so you'd say the land under their control is majority Palestinian. So either you acknowledge that and it ceases to become a Jewish state, or you ignore that and you're not a democratic state. So that's really, and this is an opinion, this is the options.
Well, but that's, yeah.
I mean, some people are fine with it not being democratic.
Well, the demographic problem is you have in the West Bank... Palestinians. I'll get to the settlements in a second. and you have Palestinians in Gaza, and then you have millions of Palestinians, or maybe about a million. I don't know. But you have millions of Palestinians spread their diaspora, and then in the refugee camps in Lebanon. What is the right of return? What is one of the things that the Palestinians want from Israel?
Well, that again is, you know, a question of debate. And I've heard Palestinians leadership say, you know, we really, you know, that's not going to happen. Maybe there's some monetary compensation. I don't think that the official position of the Palestinians is literally moving back into all the old neighborhoods, you know. I mean, and that's something you can negotiate.
But
also,
do they want to return if there's a two-state solution? Do they want the Palestinians to return to Palestine or to Israel?
No, I think what was on the table and what came very close to being resolved was, I don't know what the percentage was. It was maybe like 90% of the West Bank and all of Gaza. That number has gone. You know, some people said, well, that would have been a much better deal. So that's what they were negotiating.
But the right of return is a deal.
It was part of it, but it, again, that was something that I don't think it was a hard and fast thing that they really expected or wanted to go back into Israel. But that was something that needed to be negotiated. And
right.
So.
So the settlements, they're about, what, 300,000 Jews?
Since we started the show, I think they've gone up to 400,000.
The settlements. We keep hearing about the settlements, the settlements, the settlements. What are the settlements? Because this is what got condemned by the UN. America abstained, which kind of...
Well, it was part of it. I mean, to be fair, not to get off track, but the resolution, the UN also addressed Palestinian terrorism and violence and security of Israel. So it was a whole thing. But yeah, the settlement, Scott, you want to...
I mean, the settlements are Jews, Israeli Jews, who are saying, screw it.
From Brooklyn. They tend to be from Brooklyn.
And a lot of them do come from America.
And not all right-wing, by the way. There's actually some progressive settlements. I know someone who lives in one. So it's the reputation of right-wing settlers, but there are some. You know, Israel started with the kibbutz movement. Russia supported, Soviet Union supported Israel after its inception because they thought it was going to be a communist country.
It's a socialist country.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
But these are people who are setting up shop and you know, establishing their homes and communities, building communities in the West Bank, mostly. You know, and it's I read that these places are becoming almost little suburban communities of 6,000, 7,000 people.
Like little hovels, but they're
playing. Yeah. They got, you know, grocery stores and pharmacies and basketball courts, ping pong, and they're like, you know, little, you know, Stuyvesant towns. Set up
or Century Village,
set up in retirement villages set up around the West Bank, and you know it's a way of having a foothold in there.
Are they doing it to
in defiance? I think of the borders and all this whole situation, saying this is our homeland, we're staking a claim to it, and what are you going to do? You going to attack us? I mean, that happens. I guess there are some skirmishes.
Well, that's the thing. There's two choices. You could say, we want peace. The only way we're going to have peace is two states. And the only way we're going to have two states is it's got to be viable land for the Palestinians. So we're not going to build all these settlements. And there is plenty of room in Israel. I am, for my friends who said that there is. But aside from that, or you could say, as what people say, no, facts on the ground. We're going to change the facts. This is Judah and Samaria. This is all our land. And if we keep building, what are they going to do about it?
So they're heavily armed. So, I mean, they're all, you know, they're taking their lives into their own hands, really, because it's... It is, you know, setting up an enemy territory, so to speak.
But now, Ariel Sharon in 2005, he was a big right-wing general. Likud?
Yeah. Which is, well, I don't know if it was called Likud then.
He created his own party afterwards.
Yeah.
But he was pretty right-wing.
Yeah.
And he did like a Nixon goes to China where he removed the settlements from Gaza. There are no settlements in Gaza anymore.
Well, Gaza, there were only 5,000 Jews. So that was back in 2005. And so it was easier to do. And then again, this is important to bring up because this is when it's talked about why doesn't Israel give the Palestinians the West Bank. Look what we did. We gave them Gaza and we got rockets. I mean, this is the thing.
Right, I mean,
which is true.
And that's my parents, you know, what I've grown up with. All we want is peace. They keep attacking us, sending rockets and blowing up buses. you know, we just want to live and they're attacking us. So why, you know, and then you have to defend yourself. I mean, then, mm-hmm. then Israel retaliates. But
yeah, and what happened was, but then also what happened was the PLO, Palestinian Authority, and Hamas formed a unity government, which I thought was.
Well, the Oslo Accords that Bill Clinton orchestrated with Rabin, who was assassinated for that, and Yasser Arafat. This was about 96.
I think the Oslo weren't. I think there was another set of accords that came in early 2000, but I'm not sure of the name. But there was.
But so, the Palestinian Authority was established during the Clinton administration, and the idea was that Yasser Arafat, who was the head of the Palestine Liberation Organization, would now become a government leader,
and they the would Palestinian be, Authority, would
be, and then they created the Palestinian Authority, which was the officially recognized government of the Palestinians in Gaza and the West Bank. And they have their own little parliament, and they have their own police, and they collect the garbage, and they have elections, and they're under the jurisdiction of Israel. They were pretty much like a colony of Israel without any Israeli – well, there was Israeli supervision, but that's a fair state that in the 90s, they kind of established a Palestinian government. And it was monolithic. It was Yasser Arafat. And then they discovered that he was maybe a little corrupt, was sending money, a couple million to France, had an apartment there and a wife. That's okay. And they had a wing of the Palestinians called Hamas, which was different from the PLO. And elections were held, I guess, around 2004, 2005, in Gaza. And Hamas won. And
well, I think first of all, Hamas and this whole story was created for various reasons. Some say Israel even had some part of creating Hamas as a buffer. But yeah, they certainly.
Oh, you're saying it's a divide and conquer?
Yeah, I mean, there's some theories. But and Hamas also became more of a political, and it still to this day has a political wing and a military wing, to put it nicely. But
so there's there.
Well, I think the U.S. encouraged there to be elections.
We encouraged George W. Bush.
I don't know if it was even just Gaza. I think it was
the West Bank too. I think you're right.
And this is another important point, because people say they had elections, they picked Hamas, so they won terrorism. But if you go into the truth a little bit more, as you said, look, you know how our elections are. It was a lot more than that. The Palestinian Authority was corrupt. Some people were voting against that. And the way their parliamentary system was set up, it favored Hamas, but it wasn't an endorsement of terrorism. It was maybe some, but it was, you know, political. And then I guess what happened after that was
they won.
They had a power sharing, I believe, and then there was a civil war in Gaza that came later, and then Hamas.
Well, Israel and America, and I think Abu Mazen or Abbas Muhammad, he has two names.
Yeah.
The leader of the Palestinian Party would not recognize Hamas's victory,
mm-hmm.
and there was a civil war between the Palestinian Party and Hamas. And what's pretty much happened now is Hamas runs Gaza, and the Palestinian Authority runs the West Bank.
Right, and they've made efforts at reconciliation here and there, and it hasn't really happened. And a lot of people say that would be a bad thing. I always say that's a good thing, because first of all, if you can make Hamas more of a political entity, and the only way you're going to have a two-state solution is if both of those parties are together.
Make it three states.
Yeah, I mean, the problem is, as you said, the West Bank and Gaza, it's like, you know, New York and California. It's like the ultimate gerrymandering, you know.
So there is a battle for the soul of the Palestinians that has not been resolved.
How about the fact that Egypt and Gaza, you know, can't – I mean, Egypt won't even – Why can't there be some...
No, Egypt blocks the
Egypt
tunnels.
Blocks the, yeah.
Yeah, well, it's...
No one wants these people in Gaza.
Yeah, and so it gets down to just that you can... There's been a plan on the table. It's sort of like, well, we're doing now. What if we were Palestinian Israelis sitting, okay, all right, look, we got to figure something out. Well, and it's been acknowledged by both sides now, because, yes, there are all these settlements, but it'll be you get this, then this, and to make up for this thing that's already here, we'll give you this. It's not rocket science, you know.
Well, I think
no one wants to do it at the moment.
What's happening?
Rocket launching.
As I understand it, in the founding of Israel, there were two military arms. There was Menachem Begin, who was the head of the Irgun, very right wing, very militaristic. I believe they blew up the King David Hotel. Mm. And then there was Haganah,
yeah,
which was David Ben Gurion. Haganah was very presentable to America. They were Jeffersonian. They looked right.
British educated.
Yeah. And Menachem Begin, squat, bald Jew with a Polish accent.
Who had the eye patch?
That was Moshe Dayan.
Well, that Moshe Dayan.
Jeffrey Gurion?
Yes.
Jeffrey Ben Gurion.
So what happened in the founding of Israel is that there was a civil war between the Irgun and Haganah. And Haganah basically won, and the Irgun, which, as I said earlier, was very militaristic, became a political party, and Menachem Begin, who was pretty much ran the Irgun,
became a prime minister.
What was supposed to happen with the Palestinians was a civil war between Hamas and the Palestinian party, and then they would bend. Hamas would become like Irgun and become a political party and work within the Palestinian Authority, their parliament. It has happened, but not really. It's still, I think... I don't believe in conspiracies, but this is what I do believe. I believe that there are forces in Israel that pretty much decimated the potential for an honest interlocutor among the Palestinians.
And complaining that there's no honest interlocutor.
Yeah. I think that they kind of... So that, I'll tell you where I stand right now. I kind of lost interest in what's going on in Israel. I got my own problems.
I wouldn't know.
The whole media
hour.
Has, too. I mean, you don't really hear it talked about much.
And it's for a lot of people, especially Jews who follow this, and this is what's really sad. The Palestinian problem is a problem for Jews. It's become a chronic condition like AIDS or cancer. And it's a nation of doctors, Israelis, nation.
Great facilities.
Great doctors know how to deal with a chronic condition, you know.
Well,
and they can, you know, doctors can live with a chronic condition. They can say, you know, you're never going to get rid of the AIDS, but, you know, we've made a couple of cocktails and, you know.
Yeah. Well, the biggest difference, though, is every U.S. president and every Israeli prime minister, really, including Netanyahu. I mean, Netanyahu goes back to the 90s. He was, you know, they have the same three people with Israel. There's a great documentary. He's friendly with Arafat. And has openly talked about a two-state solution.
He's gotten more right wing.
Oh, yeah. And the Israeli government now.
Netanyahu is the prime minister.
Yes.
He's Likud. He's very conservative.
Right. And his cabinet is as right-wing as Trump's cabinet is. And that's just something...
And he's the longest-serving Israeli prime minister.
And that's just a fact. You know, it's just the same way you would... No one would refer to the American government. It's like, you know, who's president? Obama, Trump, Nixon, you know. And the same thing with Israel. And but it comes down to the biggest change now is through so long, it was like, it's going to be a two-state solution. Come on, let's figure it out. That was the accepted thing. Now, mm-hmm. sadly, through inertia, whatever, and yes, you're right, people aren't talking about it, and they should. And the reason why people are ignorant about it is because they don't have the privilege of hearing what you've said on this show, which lays it out so beautifully. They know 12% of those facts, and they pick the ones they like. But the fact is, the new, as Scott said, the new ambassador to Israel that Trump picked. This is far right. It's going to be his publicly against the two-state solution. Says if people like me who support J Street, pro-peace, pro-Israel groups, or capos who support the Nazis, Obama's an anti-Semite. This is where we're at. And I think you're right. The movement in Israel now is, yeah, let's not change it. Let's see how we can keep getting away. And what you're doing is you're sentencing mothers, daughters, children, fathers in Israel and Palestine to a lifetime of war. That's the choice, as opposed to saying, enough, Dayenu, let's sit down and make peace.
Something like 70% of Jews in Israel now are showing signs of kind of like pro-Netanyahu.
Well, I don't know what the numbers are, but, you know, I mean, again, yeah, I don't know. It has become more of a conservative country. I think the Russian influx has tended to be more conservative. And but there's only one, unless someone could explain to me better, there's only one way out that's going to be best for the Israelis and Palestinians. And it's not even the term pro-Palestinian to me. I think you can't be pro-Israel without being pro-Palestinian, because Israel will not thrive and survive if it has an adversary in the Palestinians. So, and there was a long period of time, decades, where Israelis and Palestinians worked together back and forth on the borders, and I understand why there needed to be extra security because of terrorist attacks. But the natural way for Israelis and Palestinians is to live together peacefully, and it really is not that difficult.
Right.
But people need to know at least some of the history that you laid out so beautifully.
Yeah.
They just all see Fiddler. Just watch Fiddler.
Yeah.
I'm a Zionist. I got to wrap it up. I'm a Zionist. My children are not. My children did not grow up surrounded by the children of Holocaust survivors. I think as the Holocaust survivors die off and this new generation of American Jews have to decide where they stand, are not going to be as pro-Israel as I am. And I have to admit that it's very hard for me in America to criticize Israel. I am blinded by a belief in a Jewish state. I believe in a two-state solution. My mother hates Netanyahu, who's the current prime minister, more than she hates Donald Trump. She hates the settlements. And her views towards the Orthodox Jews who are settling in the West Bank don't border on anti-Semitism. They are. I mean, what comes out of my mother's mouth is just unbridled anti-Semitism towards the Orthodox Jews.
With Jews, we do better anti-Semitism
yes,
better than yeah. anybody else.
I mean, it's just the vitriol. Right now, where I stand is. No American soldier, or very few, died fighting for Israel. Financial aid to Israel is $5 billion a year.
And the military, Obama gave a record amount, like 37.
Well, they don't give. Here's the thing. They don't give. Military. America gives $5 billion in foreign aid to Israel, which is really a subsidy to our defense industry. The $5 billion that we give to Israel, Israel uses to buy our weapons. So, look, it's nasty business, but the idea that America is giving foreign aid blindly out of beneficence to Israel, there's no such thing. We're underwriting
tit for tat
Boeing and McDonnell Douglas. We're underwriting our defense industry by giving Israel $5 billion. It comes back. Israel is the only democracy in the Middle East. Has had a female prime minister. If you ask the Arabs, the 1 million Arabs living in Israel, and they are becoming, they do feel like they're third-class citizens, and that's a problem. but they don't want the Palestinians coming back. They get to vote. They get to serve in the military. They're better off in Israel than they are in Lebanon, certainly Syria, certainly Jordan, certainly Saudi Arabia, and certainly Egypt. To the people who say divest, you know, don't buy any products that are made in Israel, then I say that includes your cure for cancer. You know, Israel is becoming
your latest favorite app. Yeah, they have a lot of
ways.
So if you don't want to use Israeli products, you know, it's not a cafeteria. You know, with South Africa, when we divested, it wasn't a cafeteria system. It's everything. So when the next cure for cancer, which they're coming out of Israel, comes down the line, you can't use it.
Well, and also many Palestinian workers work at these Israeli companies, and like the Soda Stream and all that.
That was made on in the settlement.
Yeah, right? So some people choose to buy. Yeah, I'm against the BDS movement. I mean, I don't, because I just don't think, I think it's one of those things that people think it's a victory. Like, oh, look, Stanford dropped that from their holdings. We won. Are we any closer to peace? No.
Yeah.
So, and especially don't like, some of them believe there should be no cultural or artistic cooperation, like a show like Dean and I do. There are many people, they would think, oh no, it normalizes things for Dean and I to bring people together to talk about through comedy peace.
Right.
So that's why I'm opposed to the BDS movement. I don't think it brings us closer to peace. But could I just say very quickly that, again, to all the people listening or people you might hear who say President Obama threw Israel under the bus, worse to Israel, and I think there are some racial overtones to some of that criticism, mm-hmm. is no different than any, almost any U.S. president. If the exception, they've given more money, and yes, they've put their foot down finally and said this settlement expansion is not helpful. And as you said, if anyone believes in a Jewish state, the way to get there is not what Netanyahu is doing. So if you love Israel and support Israel, Netanyahu is not supporting that path. And that's a hard reality, because I grew up in the era too. It's even hard for me. I remember bristling when other people years ago would criticize Israel, even if I agree with them. Yes, a part of me, you know, I bristle a little bit. But if we really love and care about Israel, it has to be a two-state solution, and we have to care and love the Palestinians, because the only way Israel will survive is if Palestinians do, and the only way they can both thrive is if they do it together.
How are you going to get rid of those settlements? You have 300,000 people living there.
You know what? I hope they bring that up and start negotiating tomorrow, and that's what it has to be. And not all of them, they're not going to be able to get a lot of them. Then you'll have to compensate and do land swaps. You know.
Can't you have two states and still have people choosing to live in either one of them? I mean,
the ultimate thing. And the ultimate
exclusive.
That would be great. And the ultimate sitcom would be, it's Israelis and Palestinians and settling, and you got the ornery next door neighbor and that. I hope that's what it comes down to. But that's the way it should be. Yes, ultimately, in a way, one state in a utopian vision, where everything should be, and John Lennon, you know, no borders and everything. But practically, it has to be two states. But yes, ultimately, I hope it would be that. Ultimately, also, it would be great if Jews and Israelis could live around the world and live in Arab countries again. Wouldn't that be great? And instead of also, I was in Poland, and they have these nascent synagogues there. And wouldn't the best thing be to, like, build up Eastern Europe again, too, and have more Jews there?
Yeah.
Instead, some Israeli organization came in. Hi, we want you all to move to Israel. No, let's bring Jews back to Poland.
I'd love to
Germany.
Go back to Poland. I fantasize about
Poland.
Going. I've never been, but I fantasize about moving
I loved it.
There.
I went there, and it meant so
my
much
great
to
grandfather
me.
Says, it'd be nice to go back. You know, we fled. Now we can come back.
Well, the anti-Semitism is on the rise, especially in France.
But it wouldn't
well,
be
I think a lot of that is also connected to Israel. Not to excuse it, it's horrible, and it must be horrible to be there if you're Jewish. And it's real; it's definitely real.
It's definitely
and there's
real.
More anti-Semitism in this country. And it used to be with Dean and I, it's sort of like, yeah, we went through that years ago. It's like, no, we go through that now, because no, if you hate Muslims and hate African Americans, you're not. But I like the Jews. The Jews are here.
Right.
So where we have to all be in this together. But yeah, look, there's the whole far right movement in Europe, the anti-immigrant thing. Certainly harkens back to the 30s and 40s, so we always have to be vigilant.
Mm-hmm.
But some of the anti-Semitism I do think is based on Israeli policy, which doesn't excuse it in any way, but I think some of it has to do with that.
But there are those who think that anti-Semitism is linked to anti, that there's, you can't separate the two.
Yeah.
And what it gets down to is this. Do you believe, and then we're going to wrap it up. The question you have to ask is, do you believe that there should be a state, unlike any other state on the planet, that is specifically for a religious group? Now, it's not officially a Jewish state. It kind of intimates in the Constitution that it's a place for Jews. But it's not officially a Jewish state, but it is officially a place where any Jew can come and be accepted. Do you believe that there should be a country where Jews who have been driven out of every other country for 2,000 years, and rightfully so,
because of the lack of tipping.
Do you believe there should be a country where the Jews can be left alone to cure cancer? I happen to believe that there should be a place where Jews can just be left alone to cure cancer.
Is Iran an official Muslim state? Is Saudi Arabia a Muslim state? No, but these are places where it's predominantly Muslims living there, you know, and they live there peacefully. Why, you know, we don't have a place except for Israel that Jews can do.
But sadly, you know, even though Israel is unofficially a Jewish state, I don't think Israelis feel they're living completely in peace.
No.
So ironically, the way to maybe live in peace is whatever it is and also give Palestinians many rights. Sadly, like in the West Bank, there's certain highways that only Israelis can use. And I think what's best for us ultimately is to go back. It was a pluralist vision that Ben-Gurion and these people had in the early days, kind of very more radical and socialist, and I hope it moves more in that direction. And then to close with this, when I go to look in the prayer book in the High Holidays, it says, seek peace and pursue it. Jews have been in the forefront of the civil rights movement. I think I want Israel to become more Jewish in the truest sense, and that'll bring peace between Israelis and Palestinians.
To be continued.
Next year, we do this podcast in Jerusalem.
Yeah, a year from now, it's just going to be the same thing, right?
Yeah.
Hopefully not. Hopefully there'll be more progress, but we'll see. But you really did do a great service laying it out, and I hope more people do, because the facts help.
From the Show Briz studio in downtown Manhattan, that'll do it for us.
Coming up, Daniel Lappin from Israel. Don't forget to subscribe to my show on iTunes. We have a YouTube channel. If you'd like to listen to this exact episode that you're listening to right now, you can subscribe to this show, The David Feldman Show, over at YouTube. And do all your Amazon shopping via The David Feldman Show website. Give us a good review on iTunes. That helps move us up the charts. And now my conversation with Daniel Lappin, coming to us today from Israel.
We're rolling. Do you know what that means when I say we're rolling?
I'm not talking. I'm going to keep my fucking mouth shut.
I told you to keep your mouth shut. Let me do all the talking and get us all in trouble. You know that. Daniel, what?
I've done it before. That's what I do. I get people in trouble by talking.
Daniel Lappin has been on our show before. It's been a while, though. He is a comedy writer and actor. He is the writer and creator of Israel's longest-running sitcom, Life Isn't Everything. I think it ran for 9 seasons in Israel. He's also created Split, that ran last season on Reshet, Israel's Channel 2. Please welcome back to our show Israeli comedy writer and actor Daniel Lappin. Hello, Daniel.
Yeah, hi. Everything is right, but I am not an actor. That's you just added something to my resume. I'm happy to have it, but if we're going to go with fact, no, I'm not. I've acted in my show, but just for the hell of it.
Okay, and where in Israel? Where in Israel are you joining us?
Well, Israel is very small.
All right, Just give me an answer.
I'll shut up.
I got questions I want to ask. So where in Israel?
What is it going to say to you? It's Hakadinki. It means nothing. It's a town called Herzliya. Now say it. Have you ever heard of it? Have you ever been there? It's just outside of Tel Aviv. It's a suburb of Tel Aviv. Herzliya. You got the name? Be happy.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. It's going to be tough the whole way, you know?
All right. I want to talk to you about Secretary of State Kerry, the settlements in the West Bank.
Oh, my favorite subjects. Yes. I love to talk about these things.
And you were on the show about 2 years ago when Israel was going up against Hamas and Gaza, and you're very critical of Netanyahu. You would be, I would say, associated with the Labor Party.
No. The Labor Party? The Labor Party is not a left-wing party. It's not nothing. It's I don't know what it is anymore. It used to be a very right-wing party. That's the party that initiated and executed basically the Six-Day War.
Who was Shimon Peres?
He was Labor. He then left Labor, but he was first of all, Peres, a great man. He's the man.
God, can I just do the intro without? I'm trying to get to a point.
You can't ask a question, not accept an answer. So, okay, I'll give you the short answer. Shimon Peres was a man, okay? I'll give you the answer.
Thank you.
Okay.
You're welcome. And he was beloved in America among American Jews.
In Israel, too. He was a great guy.
He was a great man. You know, I want to talk to you about the situation in Israel vis-a-vis the Palestinians. I want to inform my listeners. One of the things that I'm discovering is people have opinions in America based on opinions, not facts. So what I'd like to do with you is have you vent for a minute. Let it all out. Let me hear your anger and rage about what's going on in Israel. Then I want you to inform my listeners. Fair enough?
Okay. No. First of all, if you want me to vent and rage and let it all out, I need like around, I don't know, a week at least, just to start. That's one thing. Second of all, I don't know if I am Mr. Fact or anything. I'm not. I'm just the guy with an opinion. That's about it.
Well, unfortunately, in America, we have to turn to comedians and comedy writers to inform because we don't have journalists on radio or television. We have opinions. So give me your opinion. Give me your opinion about Secretary of State Kerry's speech and what you think of Benjamin Netanyahu, the longest serving or self-serving prime minister in Israel's history.
He's done more years than my sitcom, but he's less funny, I think. Kerry's speech, in my opinion, was a pro-Israel speech. Just a minute. I hope I'm not getting shot now. What did Kerry say? Kerry said that Israel has to choose, is it going to be a democratic state or a Jewish state?
Are you clicking your nails? What is that clicking sound? Are you doing?
I told you, it's my heart. It's my heart. No, I'm doing my nails. Yeah, I always wait for a Skype conversation from New York to Israel to do my nails. It's a thing I have. Am I clicking now?
That's the NSA or Shin Bet.
Kerry applauding quietly. I don't know.
Okay.
Am I clicking now?
With me, you're clicking. Okay.
Am I still? Oh, actually, okay.
We're doing well.
No, seriously, you're going to edit all this shit out. But
no, I'm not. Clicking? No, I'm not going to edit.
Oh, this is real live to tape. Okay. I thought that the speech was, it was great. I don't know, great. I thought it was in place. Israel is getting a blank check from the states all the time, and it's time to put a stop to this. It's like if you see somebody running around with a gun and you're going to support him, you're going to keep him with the gun? No, you're going to take the gun away from him. Putting a stop to the insane settlements and the settling, this obsessive, fanatic settling that this right-wing government is pushing forward is the right thing to do.
Do you like Benjamin Netanyahu? He's the prime minister. He is part of the Likud coalition.
No, Likud is the main party that forms the coalition. He's the party. He's the head of the Likud party, and Likud party formed a coalition with.
That's basically what I said, but you still felt the need to correct me.
No, you said it totally wrong. I just had to correct you.
What did I say? I said he was.
You said the Likud coalition. You said it right. Okay, you win.
He's the prime minister, so he had to form a coalition in the Knesset.
Yeah, it's a different political system, which is not great. Better than yours, because you have, let me think, the stupidest political system in the world. But it's not a great one here either. It's got its problems. I guess all political systems have a problem. Not like yours. Yours is really like the to win an election but lose it. That's unique for America.
Israel's won a couple of wars and lost land. So don't.
Yeah, I'm not. I'm not. I'm trying to, you know, be represent.
Right. I want to inform.
I did not vote for Netanyahu.
Who'd you vote for?
I voted for a party called Meretz, which is you can call it left wing. It's a sane party. Sanity means that you cannot continue settling. You cannot control. Wait, hold on. You cannot control. I just got a message from you. You cannot control millions of Palestinians in land where they are a clear majority.
Okay.
You cannot occupy territories and claim to be and not give them any rights.
You're going to have to let me control this conversation. Okay.
Yeah, you wanted to talk about you're a controlling guy. I see why things went the way they did with you. Go on.
You talking about my marriage?
Definitely. That's one of the topics we have to talk about, is it not?
Well, I was hoping to talk about the situation in Israel and why my ex-wife is very similar to the Palestinians, but that's neither. Are you still married?
First of all, the conflict that in the Middle East resembles, I guess, a lot of what you've been going through. Wait, are you divorced?
Pretty much.
Really? And are you happy?
Okay, so
I'm married. Yeah, I have two little kids.
Are you remarried?
You met me, I was remarried. And my ex-wife and my wife are friends. We have dinners together, and it's all one big happy family.
Okay, so you voted for what was the name of the political party you voted for?
Meretz. Meretz is a sane party. They're considered left.
You said sane, S-A-N-E.
Yeah, it's a sane party. It's a party that looks for some kind of sanity. They're a very honest party.
Is that what do they call themselves? Is that what?
No. I'm saying that it is a sane party. I do not understand the Labor Party, which for some reason you call a left-wing party. The head of the Labor Party. Wait, I'm ranting. You want to control it. Go on.
Okay. And when you vote for Meretz, you're voting for the parliamentarian who is standing in your district?
No, we don't have districts. It doesn't work like that.
They're at large?
You cast a vote and they just count all of the votes that went in for Meretz. And if they pass a certain threshold, then they have three members of Knesset. That's it. There's no district. It doesn't work like that here.
And who do you complain when the trains aren't running? Who do you complain to? Do you have
My wife, it's pretty easy to get to a member of Knesset of the party you vote. Even I had a problem and some guy from the Likud solved it for me. Of course, it was easier for me because I work with, you know, friends in the press and stuff like that. But they're accessible. You can get to members of parliament. It's a small country. So you're not talking about hundreds of millions of people. So if you make an effort, you're going to get to a member of Knesset. And a lot of these people are effective, even if they're in the wrong party. They will. You can work with these guys, even if they have, you know, their approach to the Palestinian problem is or the Palestinian the conflict is something that I could never subscribe to. Still, you can talk to a lot of these people, and they can be helpful.
Let's go over the history. Explain to us what's going on.
Come on, the history. You gotta be more specific.
What are the settlements? When I ask Americans about the settlements, they have no idea what it means. So what are the settlements?
First of all, do you want to go back to 1948, the first partition plan? Let's go to 1967. 1967, there was the Six-Day War. I can't believe I'm giving a history lesson here. So, there was the Six-Day War, June 1967, where Israel captured the Sinai Desert and the West Bank. which is mainly comprised of Palestinians who were citizens of Jordan. We captured it in a war against Jordan. The Sinai was returned to Egypt for a peace agreement, which is considered the cold peace, but it works. We haven't had any bloodshed with Egypt since 1981 when the agreement was signed. But the conflict with the Palestinians, and we captured the Golan Heights from Syria in 1967. I was barely alive then. The settlements are...
So there are two pieces of property. I cover this in the next segment of our show, but just it's hard to keep track of for my listeners, so I want to go over this. There's the Gaza Strip, which the Israelis got from the Egyptians. It's in the Sinai Desert.
We didn't get it. We captured it. It's not in the Sinai Desert. It's bordering on the Sinai Desert.
And when was that taken from the Egyptians?
1967. In the 1967 war, Israel captured the West Bank, all of Sinai, including the Gaza Strip, and the Golan Heights from Syria.
Okay, and so they returned. So when did they return the Sinai but keep the Gaza Strip?
1981. Well, it was in stages, but basically 1981, the peace accord was signed with Egypt. Sadat, Anwar Sadat, came to Israel. Let's break the stalemate. And Sinai was returned to Egypt, and Gaza stayed with Israel.
Why did Israel want the Gaza Strip? Two questions. Why did Israel want to keep the Gaza Strip? Were there a lot of Palestinians at that time living in the Gaza Strip? And
yes.
Were there a lot of Palestinians living in the Sinai Desert, or was it just an empty plot of land?
Empty plot of land. There were Bedouin tribes living there, and Gaza was overpopulated, and is even more so now.
And yes. Why did Israel want the Gaza Strip?
I don't know. I think that Egypt did not want it back. I have no answer for that. I'm not sure.
Is it because that is where a preponderance of Palestinians were living, and they wanted to watch.
Why would Israel? No.
I'm saying, is that why Egypt was willing to give it up?
Yeah. I think so. But you know what? I'm sure that any history teacher, this is a question that why did Israel actually keep the Gaza Strip? I don't know. That was a dumb thing to do. But in 2000, like 10 years ago, I think it was, Israel vacated the Gaza Strip.
Under Ariel Sharon. Yeah, but here's my question. Are there Palestinians living in Egypt? In other words, did the Palestinians just all kind of congregate in the Gaza Strip? Were they kind of forced into the Gaza Strip by the Egyptians?
After the 40, in, during the 48 war, the War of Independence, a lot of Palestinians were displaced from where they were living. People that were living in what is now Central Israel, people living in all over the country, they were displaced and they were put into refugee camps. They weren't. Yeah, what you're trying. I know what you're leaning to.
I'm not leaning to anything. You know what? I don't have an opinion. This is the other thing. I'm not arguing. I'm trying to inform my listeners because I am amazed at people, really smart people, who have opinions about Israel. Who don't know this stuff, but they have opinions. So I'm just asking you, Gaza was...
I have endless opinions about stuff. My best opinions are about things I don't know.
Okay, so Gaza, which is kind of like on the southern border of Israel and Egypt,
yeah,
is where Palestinians who were under Egyptian rule, that's where they gathered. The Palestinians after 48, after the War of Independence, or the catastrophe, as the Palestinians call it.
The Nakba, they call it the Nakba, yeah.
They were not absorbed into Egypt and made citizens. They were kind of put in Gaza by the Egyptians, right?
Right, yeah.
Is that correct?
I don't know. Were they there before? I'd have to check that. You have me again.
Okay.
I don't know if they were the result of refugees that were escaping, or how much of it was. I think that Gaza was a big city before that already. I don't know. I think that it was meant to be part of the Palestinian state in any case. But you know what?
Is it a?
I'm not sure.
Is it a coastal
Yeah, sure. They have a city. They have a, yeah, of course.
So that's one of the reasons Israel would have wanted it, right?
No, I don't think so. I it's not clear to me. I think that in 1971, Golda Meir, he offered, Sadat offered, this is how beautiful the Labor Party is.
Sadat was the leader of Egypt.
He was the leader of Egypt after Nasser, who was the nationalist, the great Arab nationalist. Sadat became the leader, and he broke the stalemate by coming to the Knesset in 1977. Knesset is Israel's parliament, and saying, let's talk peace. This was in 1977. This was after the 1973 war, very hard war. In 1971, Sadat sent an offer for peace to Golda Meir, who was then the prime minister, and said, let's make peace. You will be able to keep the areas of settlements in the Sinai. Let's just make peace. And but give me back the rest of the Sinai. In Israel, in the Sinai, there was a settlement area, an area called Yamit. Yamit was a city that Israel built, also a settlement in Sinai. Israel dismantled the settlement and gave it back to the Egyptians. According to the peace agreement that Sadat offered in 1971, we could have kept it. But Golda Meir said, we don't make peace. We're not giving anything back. We want it in a war. And I'm for peace. I'm willing to give peace. Then the 1973 war broke out, and we had a peace agreement with less advantageous conditions. This is the Labor Party, by the way.
Okay. Again.
By the way, then farther right, I'd say, than the Likud now. They've changed.
Okay. So that's the Gaza Strip. And how many people live in the Gaza Strip right now?
You know what? I don't know. I'm probably around two. I don't know. You want me to check it out as we're talking?
No, that's all right.
Millions. I don't know, maybe close to 2 million, I think, but I don't have the number.
And is it still a
source? You're talking like I'm an authority. I'm a writer. I write comedy. Yeah, go on.
Is it still a source of cheap labor? Or is anybody from Gaza allowed into Israel?
They trickle in. It's not a source of cheap labor. It's highly monitored. People that come in, it's very monitored because there's a lot of violence coming in from Gaza.
Okay. And Gaza has been pretty much turned into a cesspool? It's kind of like a walled in. Is it fair to call it a walled in ghetto where there are no real jobs and it's a Hobbesian nightmare?
Apparently unemployment is very high, but look at some pictures of Gaza on the internet. You can find places that look horrible, like 12th world, and you'll also find areas that are okay, that are not as that look more modern. But essentially what happened was Israel...
Now, answer my questions.
I don't know. You're asking, again... It's bordered from the Egyptian side. It's walled off from the Egyptians. It's walled off from Israel. They're allowed to come into Israel to work, but in very small numbers. It's not a source of cheap labor the way it used to be, like around 20 years ago.
Okay.
It is walled off, and they're not allowed to have. They don't have an airport. You can understand for security reasons why a country would be kind of worried about giving the Hamas an airport, but basically it's humanitarian stuff that gets in there.
Okay. Now there's the Gaza Strip, and it's pretty much run by Hamas, which is different from the Palestinian Authority.
Yeah, this is what we might call the three-state solution, because
Okay, and then there's the West Bank,
right,
which is run by the Palestinian Authority, which is kind of like a colonial government set up by America, the Arab League, and the United States through a series of treaties, right?
No, I don't think it's like that. They have a
president. They have Mohammed Abbas, who's the president of the Palestinian Authority, right?
Right, yeah.
And he represents the Fatah party, which is Yasser Arafat's political party from the PLO, correct?
You're doing great, yeah.
And Hamas is a terrorist organization / political party.
Religious, by the way. Very religious.
And they are challenging, and have been challenged.
They're recognized as a terrorist organization, by the way.
They're recognized as a terrorist organization and a political party within the Palestinian Authority that goes up against Fatah.
So it's not within the Palestinian Authority. They're not part of the Palestinian Authority. They're, it's like a party within a Palestinian party. They try to, you know.
It is a terrorist organization that is also a political party within the Palestinian Authority. Right?
Okay.
The same.
I don't know how much representatives, how many representatives they have in the Palestinian Parliament.
The same way Fatah would be the political party of the PLO, which is a terrorist organization.
Fatah forms the government.
Well, that's because Fatah. Give me that bullshit.
Yeah. Sorry that there are other languages other than English in the world. Why are Americans so, I don't want to say it.
Go ahead, say it. Do you know what it's like to be both a self-hating Jew and a self-hating American?
Why do the Americans believe that the sun shines directly from every American's asshole? It's not true. There's a whole world out there. There's many, many, many people that speak different languages and have different cultures. It's not all Americans as an American. As you were going to discover very soon, by the way.
Well, let me tell you something. Let me tell you something, partner. If it weren't for America, the people in Israel would be speaking German right now. And not too loudly. And don't you forget that.
Why would we be speaking German?
Because what are you clicking there? I know you're surfing the web. And knock it off.
I'm not.
You're multitasking here, and I'm trying to educate my listeners.
Yeah. Okay. Here's just one thought for you. It's true, by the way, Israel's greatest ally, but I have very serious reservations about the government here, the Israeli government. Don't look at me and say, wow, I'm proud of all that stuff. Second thing is, if America had not gone to the First World War.
Go ahead.
Going back to the First World, Second World War. I'll go back to the First World War.
Go ahead.
Go on. No, go ahead.
Say what you want to say. So
America did the right thing. But if America, it was totally the right thing. In hindsight, if America had not gone on into the First World War, there'd never been a Holocaust because Germany would have not lost the war. And
okay.
Of course, most of Europe would be speaking German, but the Nazi Party would have never been formed. Anyway, that's just all speculation. What would have happened in the butterfly effect?
Yes. Okay.
Imagine some historian is now ripping his hair out, saying, "What crap?"
Okay. Let's get back so my listeners can understand what's going on in Israel, so they have a reason to hate the Jews. my goal here is not to hate Jews just because you have a gut. You know, you're trusting your gut.
Hate Jews for the right reason.
I want you to hate the Jews trusting your brain. So the situation with the Palestinians and the settlements, I just want to paint this picture so that the audience understands. You have Gaza and you have the West Bank. Those are two non-contiguous pieces of land that belong to the Palestinians. Sort of.
Yes.
And they are ruled by what is called the Palestinian Authority, which is kind of like a parliament for the Palestinians. And the president of the Palestinian Authority is Mohammed Abbas, or Abu Mazen. He has two names. And he is a disciple of Yasser Arafat, which means he's a member of the Fatah Party, which is the political arm of the PLO, which was a terrorist organization. There was an election held in Gaza, about 10 years ago, and Hamas won. Correct?
In Gaza, yeah.
They won in Gaza, and the United States refused to accept that, and the Palestinian Authority, which is pretty much headquartered, I believe, in Ramallah in the West Bank, refused to accept Hamas into their parliament.
And so did Israel refuse.
and Israel refuse to, they kind of supervise the Palestinian parliament, correct?
Israel?
Well, Israel refused to recognize Hamas.
Yeah, I don't know what that means, supervise the Palestinian parliament. I have no idea what that means. But yeah, the Israel did not recognize the Hamas victory.
Right.
So and, I'll say like you like Hamas victory.
And so what we now have in Israel and or Palestine in Palestine.
I gotta correct a few things. In 10 years ago, Israel withdrew from.
Nobody understands what's going on.
You're painting a picture that is not right.
All right, let me wrap it up.
There's some kind of correlation.
Let me just wrap this up so my audience understands. So what you have,
and then I will correct you.
Then correct me. So what you have is you have Fatah and the Palestinian Authority controlling the West Bank, and you have Hamas in Gaza controlling Gaza with pretty much no consultation from the Palestinian Authority and Mahmoud Abbas. It's two separate Palestinian states. Is that a fair assessment?
No, it's not.
Okay.
Just hold on. It's my writing part. Okay. The Palestinian Authority, the West Bank, there is divided into certain areas, C, A, B, and C. All these territories are subject to Israeli military control. Israel can go into Ramallah at any time. There is a Palestinian security force, police force, that does a pretty good job. But Israel can go in whenever they want. They can. They also settle there. They build settlements.
We're talking about the West Bank.
In the West Bank. Israel did not withdraw from the West Bank. Israel does not go into, does not have an army base in Ramallah, but they have army bases in the West Bank, and they can go into Ramallah. They will go into Ramallah if there's need. And it's not a war, because we never left the West Bank. Israel never left the West Bank. We left certain areas in the West Bank, but not, we didn't proclaim a border there. It says, okay, we're not going to go into Ramallah. That's the easiest way to describe it. Israel did leave Gaza. Israel withdrew, built a wall, and is not, we cannot settle. Israel cannot build a settlement in Gaza. Nobody in his right mind would do that. We are not part of Gaza anymore. It's a separate entity. It's not under military rule. All of the West Bank is under military rule, under military Israeli rule. The Israeli army sits on the Jordan River, basically encircling all of the West Bank. That's why Israel is building settlements there. The settlements that were built in Gaza were dismantled. Gaza is a different story than the West Bank. It's yes. Not as if they're equal. Okay, that should be clear. And we should also say that after Israel left Gaza, Israel was bombarded with missiles from Gaza. So if you're going to be on the right, a right winger, then you can say, here's what happens when we give back land. Not only do we give back the land, but we're also getting missiles. So here's proof. Do not give back land because you're going to be bombarded with missiles.
So Gaza is more of a problem than the West Bank.
No, both of them are terrible problems.
Okay. And who? And is it fair to say that there are two separate Palestinian people or Palestinian states? Gaza and the West Bank are two separate nations.
Yeah, they're not nations. I mean,
but potentially two separate nations.
The problem, what I was trying to say was when you get missiles thrown, Israel left Gaza without an agreement. They walked out of there and they left a total mess. They had possibly reached an agreement, left with some kind of agreement, maybe it would be.
This was like 11 years ago when Ariel Sharon was prime minister.
Yeah, exactly. Gaza supposedly is closer to being an independent entity. I don't know if it's a state. They can't do much there because they're encircled by Egypt and Israel on all sides, and they can't really develop much. But you could think that if they had any, if they were peace-loving, then they could have taken all the money they built on missiles and built hospitals.
So they are more self-governing than the West Bank.
Yes.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, ask the question. I have nothing of importance to say.
There was a time before Israel pulled out of the West Bank. Pulled out of Gaza. Before Sharon pulled out of Gaza, I think it was like 11 years ago, there was an operation in the West Bank under Sharon about 12 years ago. I don't have the chronology in front of me. They cleaned out the West Bank. They found all the nasty terrorists, and they put them in Gaza, didn't they?
No, I'm not aware of that. There were always operations in Gaza when Israel had settlements there. I don't any major cleansing.
But there was a period about 12 years ago
where people were banned from the West Bank and they were put in Gaza. Yeah, it wasn't some kind of overall thing. There were several people that were some were banned into Lebanon, by the way.
So there was a period where under Sharon, the Israeli army was going door to door in the West Bank looking for terrorists and not, you know, sometimes killing them, but mostly kicking them out.
Yeah. You got to understand, there were periods where there were buses blowing up in the middle of Tel Aviv and 30, 40 people were being killed.
Yeah.
I'm not mitigating the suffering of the other side. I'm not making it look as if it was some kind of walk in the park. But people were... They didn't go from door to door every, you know, like it wasn't overall scanning all of the population of Gaza, but they...
The West Bank. They went door to door.
I meant to say the West Bank. Yeah, they were not going door to door. When you had a terrorist attack or a scare or the Secret Service was onto something, then they would go door to door to pick up
people. They were going door to door.
Whoever told you they were going door to door... Boy, you're making me right wing. When I hear this kind of stuff, you're turning me into a right wing, and that's pretty hard to do. Okay, this did not happen. Israel has in control with a very iron fist, but they were not going to every single door. You want to know what an iron fist is? It's on Purim, which is an Israeli holiday in around March, when the kids in Hebron, which is an Arab city, wanted to go to walk out in their in dressing up, because Purim is like Halloween. You dress up, but there's no trick or treat, so you dress up for nothing. But then they would put a curfew, I don't know, 400,000 Arabs in Hebron now, or I don't know how many are there, several hundred thousand. That is an iron fist. You're dealing with stuff that is not actual. It's going from door to door. You're training. It's like last time you told me when we spoke that Israel has a drone hovering outside of each out of the hospital in Gaza, and each birth is recorded. That's bullshit. It doesn't exist. Israel would not spend money on that. No government would authorize a thing like that just for the expenditure. So you have enough trouble without the inventions of going to every single door. Yeah, a lot of terrorists were ousted. Not
right. I didn't mean like every single door.
No, but it sounds like there was some kind of overall operation where thousands of people were ousted. No, it did not happen. Several of them, but tens of people, maybe hundreds, were ousted. I don't even think, though. There was one thing, I think it was under Rabin, where, 180 were ousted to Lebanon. This is what you're dealing with. It's always a conflict that is touch and go. There's never any overall thing where...
Right. Now, Rabin was the prime minister of Israel, and he was assassinated in 96.
No, 95.
He was assassinated in 95. Why don't we 95 and a half? Is that good enough?
It was 95. There's no 95. It was in November 95.
We'll say, why don't we say February of 96?
No, it was towards the end of 1995.
That why don't we say towards the beginning of 96?
Because it was the end. No, by the way, that was the saddest thing that happened that I can remember in my adult life, in a public level, where that was the death of hope. And there was a little bit of hope after Barak won, and then proved to be totally incompetent.
You're talking about Ehud Barak.
Yeah,
totally. Not Barak Obama.
Not Barack Obama. Yeah, that's also.
Do you know that if Ehud Barak married Barack?
Yes, I have. Barack. I've said
no, no. Let me do my joke. If Ehud Barak married Barack Obama, he'd be Ehud Obama.
Okay, yeah. Good joke, by the way.
Thank you. Thank Ehud Barak. So Ehud Barak, what? Say, go ahead.
I don't know. I said good use of time, good use of humor. Everything is there.
Okay. So Rabin wanted, he was strong-armed by Bill Clinton, and he and Yasser Arafat, what, in 93, 94, is that where the Oslo Accord started?
Yeah.
And they got the Nobel Peace Prize?
Yep.
And from the Oslo Accord, you have the Palestinian Authority, which is set up, where Yasser Arafat could go from being a terrorist to becoming the father of a nation. Correct?
It's a bit of a stretch, but yeah, okay, that was the idea, yeah.
And then Rabin, who was labor?
Yep.
Liberal?
Labor.
Yeah, kind of liberal. There was a parliamentary election, and Netanyahu pretty much incited the mob to assassinate him.
No, that's a real stretch.
Leah Rabin, the wife of Yitzhak Rabin, Leah Rabin said to Netanyahu when he came to her husband's funeral, "You killed him, you son of a bitch."
Yeah, okay. Listen, I don't remember saying that to him.
I added, you son of a bitch, but she said at the funeral, you killed him.
All she said was, "You son of a bitch," that's all. And he said, "Yeah, you know my mother." So, you know, it was all okay. No, there were several, it was an insane time where the country was totally split. And Rabin was being attacked by the right wing, called a traitor, and there was a parade, and the heads of the Likud were standing on some balcony, and they were there. The parade, the right wing demonstrators were walking by with pictures of Rabin in a Nazi suit, wearing a keffiyeh, and this is what. He did not incite. He did not. Netanyahu did not say go kill Rabin. He did not do anything to stop it. But I truly doubt that he believed that that was what was going to happen.
But Netanyahu was head of Likud, right wing, attacking Rabin for dealing with Arafat, and was pretty incendiary and revved up the Orthodox Jews, one of whom took it very seriously, and shot Rabin.
Listen, however you look at it, there's no way that you can pin this solely on Netanyahu. There was a whole group of Likud leaders that were on that balcony, including Sharon, by the way, including Sharon, who later changed his approach. But it's not, you make it sound like Netanyahu killed Rabin or said, "Hey guys, take a gun." No, it did not happen. That's not what happened.
Ariel Sharon, who was head of the Likud, became prime minister. Then did he form Kadima? He formed his own party after that, right?
Yeah. Yep.
Was it Kadima?
Yep.
Is it fair to say he became the prime minister? He was Likud, a war hero. He was as tough as they come. He was probably the most despised Israeli for American Jewry. They were embarrassed of Ariel Sharon. And yet, when he became prime minister, Yasser Arafat and he went eyeball to eyeball, and he was tough. But he pulled out, he was the one who pulled out of Gaza, who said the settlements have to go. And it was that Nixon goes to China moment where only Ariel Sharon from the Likud, a general who during the Lebanon War in 82, many say committed war crimes by allowing, I believe, the Christian militia to go into a refugee camp and kill Palestinians.
900, Sabran Shatila. Yeah.
Pretty much despised by American Jewry. You know, a tough general. He was going to create a Palestinian state for Yasser Arafat, and then he had a massive stroke.
I don't know how far he was going to go with that. We'll never know. He was considered a very far right-wing, tough, strong man, as you said. But his roots were in the Labor Party. He was a man of labor all his years in his youth. And
would he approve of Netanyahu right now?
I doubt it. I strongly doubt it.
That's why he formed Kadima. He didn't like what Netanyahu...
He said, "I now from here, in this role of prime minister, I see things I didn't see. And we have to reach an agreement." Listen, David, something has to be very clear. Now, let's get back to the present now. Okay, let's leave the history system lesson because it's going to be endless. Let's talk about the present for a second. It's not as if Israel has who to talk to. Olmert, who was a prime minister before Netanyahu, and Barak before that, they both offered the Palestinians dream deals. The things they'll never get. And they said no. This is fact. Clinton said it happened in Camp David with Barak. It happened later on with... They were offered everything they basically wanted, but they wanted a little more. They didn't, not everything, but in a negotiation, you'll get everything. That's one thing that should be stated clearly. That's one side of the story. The other side, now you say, if I say that, why would I be in support of what Kerry said or in support of the UN resolution, which I think is a pro-Israel resolution? Because the settlements, first of all, are draining Israel financially. And also, it costs a lot of money to build those settlements. Speculation, or I don't know, the statistics are that the government spends on a settler five times more than on a regular citizen, because each citizen costs money, except for you, by the way, David. They told me that you don't cost any money to the states. Hmm. Are you there?
Yeah, I'm listening. I'm fascinated.
Okay. Regardless of the fact that there's nobody to talk to and nobody to do a deal with, or there wasn't then, I don't know about now, you cannot build these settlements because that ensures that there will never be anybody to talk to. Because if you're going to have... Now there's over 500,000 Israelis living in the occupied territories. How are you going to get them out of there? How are you ever going to get them out of there? The more you have in there, the less chance you're ever going to have getting them out of there. Like they were removed from Gaza. There were settlements. There were several thousand in Gaza. And that was a traumatic thing for the country. So basically, the more you settle, the more chances you have of creating one state that is – has Arabs and Jews. And as Kerry said, you have to decide, are you a Jewish state? If you're a Jewish state, then you cannot occupy, you cannot continue settling because you're taking over lands with hundreds of millions of Arabs. So if you want to be democratic, you have to give them the right to vote. They'll vote in an Arab prime minister. So what do you want to do with the country? But there's no decision. I'll tell you something else. The occupied territories, except for the Jerusalem area, have never been annexed. Do you understand what I'm saying?
They were never brought into the Israel proper.
Yeah. The Arabs in East Jerusalem are considered Israeli citizens. They can get benefits from the Israeli Social Security, which is okay, and Israeli health medicine, which is only around a million times better than the crap you have in the States. Some of them choose not to do it for specific reasons, whatever. But aside from that, the Jerusalem area, which is a huge area, they keep on making Jerusalem bigger because they want to annex more, but most of the land has not been annexed. You have to ask yourself, why? We've had right-wing governments for the past 10 years, Netanyahu, why haven't they annexed it? They have not annexed it. So then you say, so if they haven't annexed it, then it's not really part of Israel. It's a different kind of land. So it's a whole mess. A country has borders.
Okay, Israel's so are you saying they haven't annexed East Jerusalem?
No, East Jerusalem has been annexed.
But they're putting settlements where? In Jerusalem, right?
Well, the Jerusalem area. No, they're putting settlements in the middle of beside Hebron, not in the Jerusalem area, not in what is considered the municipal area of Greater Jerusalem. All over the West Bank, all over areas that are far from Jerusalem, that are isolated, that even in any, even if there was a land swap. You would never swap those pieces of land. It's doing it as a kind of thorn in the face of the world and the Palestinians, putting settlements in far out areas in the middle of Palestinian populations. And then, of course, the army has to guard those. There's also another thing that settlements will be put up that are illegal, and the Supreme Court of Israel will say this is illegal. You can't have a settlement there. You know, they will rule that you have to dismantle it. The government then will then argue that. I mean, the government is basically doing illegal stuff against, like, as if it hates itself. It hates the country because I guess abiding by the rules of the Supreme Court is something that is mandatory to keep a normal state running.
The nation of Israel is being changed by Netanyahu. There was a time when there was a vocal opposition. He has kind of, aren't people kind of shutting up about him now? And isn't a new, I think I read a Pew poll that said more and more Israelis are throwing up their hands and saying, you know what? I don't think a two-state solution is possible anymore.
He is not putting people in jail. We're not talking about.
But are more and more Israelis becoming right-wing when it comes to the Palestinian question?
Yes, totally. Like in the world, by the way, what's happening in the world? There's some kind of insanity that's going on in the world. I don't know. It might be a result of. I can only speculate. You know, you'd see Brexit, you see the Trump victory. Well, that was actually a Russian victory, but you see this insanity that's overtaken the once sane countries of the world. You say, okay, we have it too. I don't know how sane Israel was, but it was saner. Maybe it's some kind of response to ISIS, to the insanity that's going on with the fanatic Islamic groups that threaten to take over the world, and though power, as far as power is concerned, they can't do it. But when you see somebody's head chopped off, it scares the shit out of you.
And when you see what's going on in Syria, it scares.
Yeah, that's just the north of here.
Do you believe?
No, but listen, there's also the left wing approach. Like, I have a friend. We talked about ISIS, and I said, what do you think the world should do with ISIS? And he said, build them schools, and they'll have what to lose. And I said, no, you build them schools, they'll have more places to rape. That's it. The only way you can meet groups like ISIS is in the battlefield with weapons. And I don't think that it's like Europe in 1938 appeasing. This is the reaction. I think that this is not going that way. But thank God.
So how do you see, you're a liberal?
Yep.
You're a progressive?
Yeah.
You still think a two-state solution is possible?
Definitely. I think that's the only hope this country has.
And where would that country, where would the Palestinian state be?
It would be in the ideal world. We would remove all the settlements, or 95% of them. It's not going to happen, though. This, you know, I'm just talking. I'm a disillusioned liberal. It's not going to happen. But at least don't settle anymore. The settlements are destroying the country, and it would be in the West Bank and in Gaza with some kind of arrangements for them to pass between the two, some kind of connecting road between the two. It's not an ideal situation, but in times of peace and trust, then everything works, doesn't it? I mean, you have all sorts of weird.
And it would be its own nation, the nation of Palestine.
Well, you know, you'd go at it, I guess, in stages. You wouldn't give them an air force the next day.
Right.
But it would be the nation of Palestine. That's exactly what it would be.
And what do you think is the number, percentage-wise, of citizens of this new nation called Palestine who recognize the right of Israel to exist?
I don't know. That's a question I can't answer. I can answer how many people support in Israel what I'm saying, and that would be me, my wife, not sure about my sister anymore,
anymore.
And there's a guy down the street that I spoke to. I think he's there's no support for that. I think if push came to shove and there was a real offer for peace, Israelis would then in a national poll, they would support it. They would support some form of peace. Everybody was very pro-rubbing at the beginning. But when you have people exploding in buses and 30 people being wiped out at a shot, then it's hard to see the light at the end of that tunnel. It's a bloody tunnel.
Ehud Barak, before you go, Ehud Barak was defense.
He grew a beard. He's a hipster now.
He grew a beard. He was, I guess, the defense. He became defense minister after the Camp David Accords failed with Clinton in 2000. He became defense minister, and I remember him saying, we need to build a wall. Build a wall, and that will put an end to the suicide bombers. So they built a wall. They built a wall between the West Bank and Israel proper. And people say walls don't work, and walls are violating Palestinian rights and infringing on their land.
They are.
Yes.
Of course they are.
Did the wall work?
Of course.
Say that again.
Almost no suicide bombers anymore.
So the wall did work.
No. It's not only the wall. It's intense work of intelligence in the occupied territories. By the way, there's a great television show called Fauda. It's on Netflix now. A guy I know. It happens that his daughter and my son go to the same school, in the same class, actually. He created it. It's called Fauda. Watch it. You will get insight to what's going on. It's not biased to Israel. It's a really good show.
How do you spell it?
Fauda. Fauda, I think. And it's on Netflix. It was subtitled, but it's really – it'll give you insight to how the day-to-day mechanism of the security of both sides works. Watch it.
Okay.
So I can't say it's only the wall, but the wall had a lot to do with it. But why am I saying the wall was infringing on Palestinian rights? Because it was built on Palestinian land. They could have built it, you know, a couple of miles west. They could have picked it up to the sky and done it on Israeli land. But no, they did it on Palestinian land. Does that bother me? Of course it bothers me. It didn't have to be done like that. It was insensitive. Israel is immune to any kind of humanity when it comes to that kind of stuff.
There are a million Arabs living in Israel proper.
I think there's more. There's 1,700,000 in there.
Do they identify as Israeli or do they identify as Palestinian? What would they call themselves?
I don't know. I'd say most of them identify as Palestinian. What do you identify yourself as?
Well, it's fluid. Some mostly a man.
Yeah, by the way, I've heard people talk about that. Don't be sure.
Do they call themselves Israelis?
I don't know. I imagine that a lot of them have a Palestinian sensibility. I mean, a generation and a half ago, they were Palestinians.
Do they vote in Israeli elections?
Not enough.
Do they pay taxes?
They have they do. They're supposed to. They don't go to the army. Some of them can volunteer.
They don't go into the army?
No, they're not. It's not mandatory for them to go into the army. Am I surprising you now?
Are they a fifth column?
I don't know. It's hard to say. As far as funds are concerned, they're the last priority of the Israeli government. When you go to one of these Arab villages, and you can see sewage in the streets. Not all of them, but they're not. They don't get what the regular Israeli towns get. Cities.
When Israeli Arabs who have citizenship.
I don't know, but the question you're asking is, where is their loyalty? To who is their loyalty? Some, I guess it's, I don't know. I guess they're conflicted. The answer is somewhere in the middle. Who are you? I mean, you're an American and then a Jew. You're not loyal to Israel. But I'm just curious about how it would work for you.
You want to hear the best joke I wrote in 2016?
Yeah.
About Bernie Sanders?
Gone.
By the way, it's the best joke I ever wrote for 2016. Submitted it to...
The buildup is terrifying. Go on.
It's the best joke I wrote all of last year. I submitted it to three separate shows that I was working on. Everybody said, this is a great joke.
Nobody did it.
We can't do it. My concern about Bernie Sanders is, you know, as a president, he's, you know, he's Jewish and an American, and there's a dual loyalty. What side will he take if America ever goes to war with Alan Sherman Records?
Right. Okay. And nobody did that?
And rightfully so.
Yeah. I had a joke like that. I had a joke that I wrote that nobody ever wanted to do. But it wasn't political. It was just some obscene joke about some lawyer, some female lawyer who was having an affair with the guy she was representing, who was in jail. And she then said to the judge, deep inside, I know he's straight. And forget it. It doesn't translate into English. But
let me try, because I have one more question, then I'll let you go.
Yeah, go on.
I'll let you go. Finish the joke. Let me just see if it's...
No. Deep inside, I know that he's straight as a ruler, something like that. I don't think it translates.
What's the punchline?
Deep inside, I know that he's straight as a ruler. Deep inside, it was double meaning, but it doesn't translate.
Thank you for putting an end to that vicious stereotype that all Jews are funny.
I thought you did that at the beginning of the time. Oh, forget it.
Okay, last question.
Unless you're not Jewish.
We should do this more often. This was fun. Yeah. And I do think the listeners kind of got the lay of the land.
I don't know. It sounded kind of mumble jumbled, and I didn't have the numbers right because I'm just on my job. But okay.
This is never going to be on CNN or MSNBC. Maybe Rachel Maddow.
But there are going to be hundreds of people listening to this. Literally hundreds of people.
You'd be amazed by how many listeners we have.
What, did you reach the 550?
We have a lot of listeners. We do. And it's growing because of shows like this.
By the way, my favorite show when I am in the States is the Mark Levine show.
Oh, the right wing.
Yeah. Oh, that is so funny. It's like a parody. I developed imitations. I perform with that thing.
Have you ever heard of Michael Savage?
No.
Oh, you got to listen to Michael Savage.
I promise you, I will.
Michael Savage, SAVAG. His real name is Michael Wiener. He's a Jew from Brooklyn.
He does
the right wing act, and he's syndicated. He's very successful, very well read, very literate. He's a combination of Jackie Mason, Mort Saul, and Strom Thurmond.
Wow, going back there.
Yeah, it's very entertaining. Final question.
I want to express a fear, by the way, that I don't think it's intentional, but I think that your new president, the president-elect, as he's called, until the 20th of January, is going to cause serious bloodshed in this area. If he does, in fact, move the embassy.
I was just going to ask you about David Freeman, the new ambassador to Israel.
He calls you a capo if you're in J Street.
There are two lobbying organizations. They're not actually lobbyists, but they're called lobbyists. J Street and APAC. APAC is right wing. J Street is a new left wing Jewish lobbying organization. And David Friedman is Donald Trump's bankruptcy attorney, who's now going to be the ambassador to Israel. You would think, being Donald Trump's bankruptcy attorney, he'd be exhausted from all that work.
Work. The word you're looking for is work.
Yeah. And he wants to move the American embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. And that is a bone of contention. Why is that significant?
What do you mean by significant?
Huh?
I hold on. I'm just answering my writing partner who's freaking out.
Why moving the embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem? Why will that alienate the world? And then you can go.
Thank you. You're a kind man. You're a kind Jew.
I'm kind of a Jew.
That you can tell me, I don't know, or your ex-wife's side, she will know how much of a Jew you actually are. That and the Moel.
That's the guy who does the That's the Jewish penis barber who takes a little. He takes a little off the top, but leave the sides. Leave the sides.
Yeah. And he earns most of his money in tips. Anyway, I apologize for that. Anyway, it's because it's declaring something that hasn't been finalized. Listen, as an Israeli, and a Canadian, and an American, but an Israeli, the capital of Israel is Jerusalem. No way, you're not going to convince me that it's not. But there is a problem with East Jerusalem, where you have hundreds of thousands of Arabs living. Should it be Israel's capital? Yes. Should it be the capital of the Palestinian state? Yes. In some kind of phenomenal peace agreement where everybody loves everybody, it's a joint capital. But we are not there yet. We are decades, maybe centuries away from that. By moving the embassy to Jerusalem, you are declaring that this is the capital. You are finalizing something that has not been finalized. Should it be there? Theoretically, yes. Can it be there now? No. It will create violence that is unbelievable. There are certain areas you do not touch. One is like the dome of the mosque, Arab mosque on top of the in Jerusalem, on top of the mount, where the Western Wall is. Don't touch it. Jews shouldn't go up there. There's all sorts of areas that are very, very, which, in my opinion, it's all insane. But be smart.
Didn't Sharon initially?
Hold on. There's something about being smart and not being right. I'll give you another example. If I was right wing, how did Israel magnetize such anger on itself? There was a law passed. There's in the Israeli parliament, there's three stages for passing a law. One thing is a law called Chokah Hasdara, the law of regulation, I guess, which basically in very simple terms says any land that Israel confiscates from Palestinians in the occupied territories can become legal if we compensate in a certain way. And it's basically regulating illegal stuff, in which case the Supreme Court will not be able to say you can't do that. It's a way around the Supreme Court. Now, when Israel passed this law, in the State Department, they were freaking out. This is like in October, I think, or November. They were freaking out. Why pass that law? If they had any brains in their head, they would have waited till after the election. They would have waited till the 20th of January. They would have passed a law. Then they would have – nothing would have happened. But I just don't get it. There's some kind of insanity of taking on the world. And it's a little country. And Netanyahu is now scaring the shit out of the world by reprimanding everybody. Anyway.
Light the fire for the Second Intifada?
Oh, yes, of course. He went up to the Temple Mount, definitely. He was the guy that did it. Just for your listeners that don't know, the Temple Mount is an area that Jews, according to certain halachic, that's a rabbinic authorities, you're not supposed to go up there for Jewish reasons, for religious reasons. Other Jews have found ways to go around that. It's a very explosive area. Don't go up there. There's no reason to go up there unless you want to make a point and you want to light a fire. Sharon did go up there, but that was to topple the government that was in Barak's government that was around before that. That was a calculated, cold and calculated political move. Anyway, so but back to your question. I fear that Trump's support, blind support of Israel, support of, you know, supporting the settlements, sending an ambassador who was right-wing as the settlers themselves, sending a guy like that in is going to ignite fires. It's not a wise thing to do. Even if you're right-wing, you should be smart about what you're doing and not try to make a point.
Last two bonus questions.
Okay. Well, it's a yes and a no, depending on, you know.
Socialized medicine?
Don't start me on that one. Are you serious now?
Yeah, it works, right?
Well, I would know. You wouldn't. Yeah, let me tell you something. It works. I have a brother whose stepson had cancer. If my brother didn't have money, that kid would be in the ground now. But he's not. He's healthy. It's unbelievable. It's just phenomenal. I'll never get this. I don't know if this is true. I heard that Doctors Without Borders, you know that thing, doctors that go around the world?
I have a mother without borders.
I have a country without borders. But anyway, you know what I'm talking about? Doctors.
Oh, sure. Yeah, they're heroes. Yeah,
right. They go to Africa. They go to poor countries in Asia. The most work they had was in California. Is that true? I'm not sure. It's a funny story.
Oh, when they had like medical fairs, I think, in Inglewood, and people came out. Yeah, people are in trouble here in the United States.
This is an you live in an insane country. A country that looks at socialized medicine as a communist plot is insane. It's just, I mean, I guess that a guy that doesn't work is entitled to, I don't know, he's not entitled for a trip around the world. He shouldn't have a swimming pool in his backyard, but he should be able to get chemotherapy. That, yes, whether he works or not.
Well,
that's irrelevant.
You have a draft?
What do you mean a draft?
You have a draft. The reason
I have a play, I wrote a play and I have a draft. Yeah, you want it?
No, the reason Israel has socialized medicine is because everybody has to serve in the military.
Bullshit. No, that's not true.
Well, if you're not Orthodox.
No, everybody. No. Israel was founded as a welfare state. Like Canada, like England, like Sweden, it's less of one now. It's becoming more like America. But the basic foundation of a welfare state, which is socialized medicine, is that feature is still there. It has nothing to do with the army. It's just the way a country is run. How many countries do you think don't have socialized medicine? Most of them do. It's just
industrial. Yeah. But you do have to serve in the military in Israel, and I think that makes for a smarter citizenry. You pay attention if you got some skin in the game. And Olmert?
That's not why Israel has socialized medicine.
Okay. Olmert, is he still in prison?
Yeah. And our president just got out of prison.
How many years?
Our president was in prison. Sounds like a tongue twister. Our president was in prison. Our president, Katsav, the guy before Peres, was in prison for rape. I think on two accounts he was convicted.
What's his last name?
Katsav, which means, in translation, butcher. He was in prison for rape and...
Not all. I thought it was Olmert.
Oh, no. Olmert is also... He was the prime minister. Israel has a president, which is a totally useless thing. He just shakes people's hands. He's like the queen, but with a penis. It's because there's never been a female president. And he shakes people's hand, and he's the head of state. And after the election, he calls on the guy. It's his decision to call on the guy to form a government who's going to be prime minister. But it's basically a ceremonial thing. So Israel's president was in prison for 5 years for rape. And Israel's prime minister, former one, Olmert, is in prison now, I think, four or 5 years for taking bribes. So you could say one of two things now. Israel is a very, very honest, clean country because, look, we even put our presidents and prime ministers in jail. Or everybody is corrupt and their day will come.
Well, I think we should be putting our – you know, when Gerald Ford pardoned Nixon and said, you know, our national nightmare is over, they always say it's good for the country. Why is it good for the country if we don't lock up our presidents, you know,
not good for the country.
What?
Oh, it's not good for the country. It's lies, suddenly contempt. I don't think it's good for the country.
You think it's when Trump was saying lock her up, you think that's bad for the country?
Of course that's bad when he was saying lock up Hillary Clinton.
But don't you think it's noble that a country can put a president and prime minister on trial and lock him up?
Definitely, yes.
You think it's good, right?
Yes, of course. But that's not the case of Hillary Clinton. That was not the case for her. That was just a ploy to an election ploy. It was an insane populist election ploy, lock her up. We'll never understand what went on there with this guy Comey coming out 12 days before the election. I don't get it. It's like it reminds me of – it's worse than what goes on here, by the way, when it comes to the election. It's just insane.
Daniel Lappin is a – terrific comedy writer, and he's the creator of Israel's longest-running sitcom, Life Isn't Everything. How can people contact you and complain?
First of all, after some of the stuff I said, I'm sure that I'll be contacted by people that are not happy. How can they contact me? What do you want me to give my phone number?
Do you have Twitter? Do you have Twitter?
I am on no social media.
Any anti-social media?
That's a good one. But time is such a valuable thing. And the amount of time that is wasted, I mean, as it is, I surf the web. Like when I have to write something, suddenly it's important to discover who invented the pencil. So I will spend 10 minutes, who invented the pencil. So there's enough time wasting as it is doing the dishes. You know what it is like to write. You'd rather do anything than write. So getting on social media, I think that's, you know, that's a limit I put on myself. It's like, you know, going on a diet. I have no social media. I have an email. I can give you my email if you want to write me.
Well, do you want to let my listeners?
Yeah, I don't care. I have several emails. One, the stuff I don't read. I'll give them the one I don't read, okay?
Well, then they're not going to take it down.
I read. They read it. I'm joking. I'm just so hilariously funny right now. It's D for Daniel, Lappin, L-A-P-P-I-N, at netvision, N-E-T-V-I-S-I-O-N, .net.il. Now, let's do that in a more coherent way. D Lappin at netvision.net.il. I can be contacted like that.
Great. Thank you, Daniel.
Great talking to you again. If ever you need a misrepresentation of history, I'm here for you.
That's our show. I want to thank Scott Blakeman, Scott Rogowsky, and Daniel Lappin for taking time to explain a very complex situation in the Middle East to us. And I hope you were, I don't think I brought you completely up to speed, but now I think when you read the paper and try to understand what's going on in Israel and with the Palestinians, you'll have some touchstones. If you don't follow this stuff, it's very complicated. You won't hear this on any television news show or any radio news show because, you know, there's no money in this. You won't even find it on the PBS. Occasionally, you'll find it on the PBS. All right. Is that it? Follow me on Twitter. Friend me on Facebook. Do all the things I've been asking you to do. From the show Briz Studios in downtown Manhattan. That'll do it for us.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.